Well, good morning to everyone and welcome to this, the 9th meeting of the Economy, Jobs and Fair Work Committee. May I first of all welcome our guests, Linda Hanna, Managing Director of Strategy and Sectors, Scottish Enterprise, Charlotte Wright, Interim Chief Executive, Highlands and Islands Enterprise, Dr. John Kemp, Interim Chief Executive, Scottish Funding Council, and Douglas Duff, Head of Economic Development and Environmental Services, Falkirk Council, and Chair of Business Gateway Management Group. We also have Gordon McGuinness, Director of Industry and Enterprise Networks of Skills Development Scotland, who is slightly delayed, I think, due to travel difficulties, as is one of our committee members. So I'll start the meeting by putting in apologies from the committee member, Liam Kerr. I'll remind everyone in the room to turn off electrical devices or turn them to silent, please, so as not to interfere with the work of the committee. The first item on the agenda is to take items 4 and 5 in private by decision of the committee. Is that agreed?
Yes.
Thank you. So we'll then, having welcomed our witnesses here today, start off with some questions to you. And there's no need to switch your mics on or anything. This will be dealt with by broadcasting. And I would like to ask something about regional economic strategy, but I think we'll first of all turn to the deputy convener, John Mason, who would like to ask a question about overall structures. So over to you, John.
Okay, thanks, convener. Good morning. Yes, I'm interested in where we're going with all this, and I realise that none of you are actually making the decision and you're all parts of the kind of overall equation as to where we're going, but I'm interested in your views as to where we might be going. And, I mean, I see the word simpler appearing in the review at various times, including Keith Brown's comments that we want a coherent and simpler, more flexible and cost-effective system. But at the same time, I'm seeing the idea of a new statutory board, and I'm seeing the idea of something for the south of Scotland. So that doesn't seem simpler to me. That seems like more organisation. So I just wonder if any of you can explain to me or give me your thoughts as to where we're going with all this. Is simpler important? Does it need to be more joined up than it has been?
I'm happy to pick that up first.
Yeah, Charlotte Wright.
No doubt colleagues will want to come in as well. I mean, I think firstly, we appreciate having seen feedback from users as part of this review process that clearly there was a strong message in there about people wanting it to see the process easier for users to navigate. So I think there is a key point in this, how we deliver services more simply. In relation to the strategic board, I think we welcome the opportunity to have that strategic oversight across our agencies working together. You're absolutely right in terms of the detail isn't there yet. So our assumptions at this stage on how that'll work is that there will be that strategic board. We've yet to see exactly what that will mean for the boards of the individual agencies as they currently exist. We did have the Convention of the Highlands and Islands yesterday in Inverness, and Mr. Brown was present at that and did respond to some questions from local authorities who were very keen, not surprisingly, to see that we would ensure there continued to be a strong Highlands and Islands voice into that strategic board and how that works going forward. So I guess what's really important to us is how we work together through these next implementation stages in phase two to ensure that whatever the changes bring, and we welcome those opportunities, actually we ensure that the things that have made the most difference that we can point to in terms of the success from my point of view of High and the Highlands and Islands over the last 50 years, that legacy continues into our new structures going forward.
Okay, I mean, that's helpful. I mean, I suppose the radical option would be to have one organisation with five branches. But I'm not sure if anyone's actually suggesting that or if that would be a good or a bad idea. Does anyone else want to come in?
Sana? So thank you very much. Just to build on what Charlotte has been talking about,
One of the things that we were very clear about in our submission to the Enterprise Review and building on the Audit Scotland work was looking at, there is a very clear economic strategy that kind of sets out what wants to be done for the country, but is very high level. We feel that there is an opportunity around a clear plan that actually builds, you know, and binds everybody together to kind of look at those outcomes that we're looking for the economy, and very clearly puts at the centre of that what those outcomes are. So rather than necessarily one organisation being clear about how we all work together, not just as agencies, the growth of our economy is also dependent on many other organisations and about how all that works together. So the clearer that we can be around putting the economy at the heart of that, the things that make a difference, and about making sure we're all going in that direction, we think would be something that would actually kind of support that to go forward.
So do you feel in the past the five haven't always been going in the same direction as much as they could have been?
Maybe I could just come in. I mean, we did have, when we do continue to have separate agencies, so in terms of what ourselves and Scottish Enterprise would do, there are a number of areas where we are doing similar sorts of things to provide support to businesses, but Highlands and Islands exists for a set of reasons that we work with a different business community. We also have a community development remit, and we're working within the geographic and social challenges of the Highlands and Islands. So that means that we do different things in a different way. So whilst at an overarching strategy level, we're absolutely doing the same things and performing to Scotland's economic strategy, in terms of that delivery, some of the how we do things will be different.
Mr. Kemp?
I very much echo that. The five agencies will be five. They do different things, and sometimes do them in very different ways. But there is a significant overlap, and there is a synergy, even when we're doing things that don't overlap, that, you know, that influence each other. And I think it's important that we, and I think this has been something that's common to all of the discussions that we've had as part of phase one of the review, is seeing a way of linking the government's economic strategy to what we do by some board or other mechanism that brings the agencies together is something we've seen as very important. Now, that could simplify things depending on what happens with other levels of governance and so on, but I don't quite see it the way that you'd suggested as, you know, one agency with five branches. The agencies are quite different from each other, but there is a synergy that we must extract the maximum benefit from.
I mean, Mr. Duff, how do you see that? Because from a local government point of view, should it not be too centralised, or would it be better being more centralised?
I think Business Gateway is part of local government services, and certainly we welcome any opportunity to simplify, make more seamless the services that we're offering. As part of the inputs that were made by COSLA, by SLADE, which is the National Body for Economic Development, officers in Scotland, we've certainly welcomed any moves that can be made to simplify and make more straightforward the arrangements. Importantly, we've been blending services at local level, but we try and maintain a consistency across the country, and we work very closely with the national agencies to achieve that. So I think we see that this is all part of a direction of travel to simplify. But it is important that it maintains the scope for local flexibility as well as a nationally consistent picture.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you.
Just one point further on that. I hear the message that you are all separate but together in some way. Do you see some scope for collaboration in terms of back office services? You see this maybe scope there to maybe save some money so that you can reinvest in what you do and try and reach out to small businesses?
Well, we actually have a live example of that at the moment in terms of our information and IT support, which is shared across SDS, Scottish Enterprise, and ourselves through an organisation, EIS. So we've seen that we can do that kind of thing. And I guess that gives us the opportunity to see what further we could do.
And similarly, we share some HR services with the SQA, so that kind of thing is going on both within the agencies that are part of this review and wider.
When it comes to local government, are you in the same mindset?
CRM system that has been developed jointly between Scottish Enterprise and Business Gateway, and that's a means of maintaining a close understanding of the business growth pattern that any company takes and all the interventions that are made to that company. So there's been quite strenuous effort in building that system and making sure that it meets the needs of business.
If I can add, I think we've already got those things in place and we already collaborate well around those. I think there is an opportunity to go further around some things, particularly in our submission we talked about there is an opportunity to jointly share our approaches around continuous professional development where our, you know, colleagues across agencies, not just in these agencies but wider, do a similar role, so business advice, project management, etc. We could share, you know, how we do that. We've done that for many years over Business Gateway. We work together with hiring that, but we could look at how we could go further than that and that kind of make sure we share best practice. One of the things that is in a recommendation in the review around looking at that kind of shared data and intelligence and about how we share that much more. We do that informally already. Lots of that goes on right now, but there is an opportunity to go further with that and make sure that that underpins what's decided around this new strategic board, but also informs the services, and particularly as we move much more to digital enabled delivery service models in the public sector as well as the private sector, there's going to be even more an enrichment of those kind of insights. So being able to share that is something that we're all very keen on how we do that, just to make sure that we're continuing to serve what customers are looking for and that getting a sense of that's making a difference on the ground.
You've kind of second guessed my next question, probably my last question, that commonly particularly small businesses really don't know where to go, or they get confused, and in some regards, there's too many doors. Is there a way to, you see scope also in this change that's taking shape to help? I really speak up for one or two peopled businesses who are only, you know, interested in running their business. They don't have time to perhaps that bigger companies have got more staff to kind of find their way to that door. So is there an element of this that where we can make it much easier to signpost and make it, you know, more distinct, and, you know, so that it's easier for the customer that you talk about?
The recommendation in the review of no wrong door, I think, is a really powerful one, and particularly the opportunity using digital to make sure that that's a simple, straightforward digital portal that all businesses can use and make sure that they get through to the right part of government or agency that can help them with whatever their particular need is. So that I think we would probably all say that we've done as over time tried to make sure that that looked as simple as possible, but recognise that there is feedback in the review report which says we can do more there, and as I say, the principle of no wrong door I think is one we would all really support, so that we make that as simple and transparent as possible for business. Absolutely agree with your remarks. A business has no time to try and negotiate its way through something. We should make that as simple and straightforward as we can.
Thank you. I see that Gordon McGuinness has now joined us. Welcome, Gordon, to the...
There was someone took ill in a train in front of us at Edinburgh Park.
Right. I'm sorry to hear that, but thank you for coming today. And we'll let you get a little settled before I think anyone throws questions at you. But just to fill you in, we're discussing the overall structure of the enterprise agencies at the outset of today's meeting. So I'll hand over to one of our committee members, Jackie Bailey, who has another question on this area.
I should record my apologies, convener, for being late for exactly the same reason that Gordon McGuinness was. Can I ask the panel, one of the recommendations arising from the review is that there should be a strategic board. But it's my understanding at the moment that you have a strategic forum where you all sit round the table with government officials and with ministers. What difference does statutory underpinning going to make? To Linda first.
So thank you very much. I think the difference this makes is around this needs to be much more than just a board. I think this needs to be a board that is really genuinely considering what that plan is going to be in terms of how all of this works together, what the outcomes that it's seeking to drive, and then making sure that it focuses on those. The strategic forum has been much more of a collaborative forum in that sense, which I think works well, but I think this board gives an opportunity to have a much clearer line of sight around around how that links to the outcomes in the National Performance Framework, how that links to the key drivers of productivity in the economy that are really important, how that links to the different roles and responsibilities, and we've described that we bring different expertise to Scotland's economy and to the landscape at the moment. So it's about how that joins that up, and increasing how that has the private sector at the table. So the Strategic Forum very much is the kind of partners there, but a board would bring the private sector around the table as well. So I think it brings an opportunity to have an even stronger focus on the economy, a stronger focus on the actions that need to be taken, and then around being agile and kind of flexible around over time, the types of actions that will need to be taken around how that flows through to what happens on the ground with customers.
So I should say, for Gordon's benefit, Gordon McGuinness' benefit, that if you wish to come in on a question or on the discussion, if you simply indicate by raising your hand, and then I'll seek to bring you in at an appropriate point. Thank you. Sorry, Jackie Bailey.
I'm interested to hear other views, and then I'll come back.
To add to that, and I suppose I'll caveat this remark with it's an assumption rather than knowledge at this point, as we still have yet to see how things are implemented. But I think perhaps there's an outward message about it being a strategic board underpinned by statute as much as the internal message about how we as agencies work together differently across Strategic Forum and Strategic Board. And perhaps that, you know, goes to the message that we've had from users of service about needing to understand that. So I see that also about a powerful outward message that there is one board which makes sure that it gives overarching strategic direction, collaboration and challenge to us as the agencies.
Thank you. Dr. John Kemp.
I very much agree with it and what my colleagues have said. I think that there was always more than one way of doing this. I think a statutory board shifts the balance of the responsibility in a direction that's different from the Strategic Forum, which was, you know, a collaboration between bodies which had boards that were tasked with different things. So I think it brings things together in a way that a non-statutory board perhaps wouldn't do. But a lot of the detail is still to be worked out in phase two of the review. You know, how that will operate, how it will interact with the five agencies, you know, it's something we still need to see.
Can I ask, because I was not, you know, clear that there was any clamour for this from any of the agencies, that you all think this is a really good thing. And I'm genuinely surprised that a strategic board, you know, with John Swinney, Deputy First Minister, you know, in charge, doesn't seem to have achieved that much. And you're saying it really wasn't fit for purpose and you needed something else. I'm just slightly confused.
I
don't know if we were saying it wasn't fit for purpose, but there's an opportunity perhaps to give that, my contribution there is about giving a powerful outward message about how we are working together under a new strategic board. But I certainly wouldn't say... Sorry?
Which the forum didn't do then.
I wouldn't say that the forum hadn't been fit for purpose.
Okay. Right. Thank you. Perhaps we could move on to something slightly different. And I would like to ask a question about the regional economic strategies, and we've looked at the overall structure so far. I see in the Scottish Enterprise submission to the Scottish Government, there's reference on page 10 of the documents we have. It may be a different page number in the original report, but talking about Scottish Enterprise's work with the three Ayrshire councils to develop a shared regional economic strategy. Now, I'm interested in that because, of course, if we have agencies looking at the national Scottish picture. Scotland is a very diverse country in economic terms from region to region, and indeed the workforces in different areas, the local economies, what they're focused on can be very varied and very different. And I think Ayrshire and the three Ayrshire councils area is an example of that. So I'm just wondering how you think the agencies can be best organised or best approach what I would call perhaps localisation of approaches, getting away from the idea of simply national strategies, which obviously may be necessary, but the difficulty is always in the detail and indeed at local level. John Kemp.
Yeah, that's something that we've very much recognised for some time, that one size fits all doesn't suit all of the colleges and the need for all the colleges and universities that we fund. So for the last few years, we've been funding colleges through regional outcome agreements and universities through outcome agreements, which are regional to various extents. And that recognises, as you say, that some regions have different economic needs from others, that the skills needs will vary from region to region. So we fund a college or a university based on a document that we agree with the college or university, based on a regional skills assessment from Gordon's organisation, SDS, and based on our outcome managers discussing with the college and other local stakeholders what the needs are. So we hope through that we are recognising that there are different regional needs in different parts of Scotland. There are some things that are needed in most regions, but there are some things which are very specific. So we do that through regional outcome agreements and teams of regional outcome managers who work closely with the colleges and universities in their areas.
Charlotte Wright.
So as a representative of a regional organisation, clearly I come with a regional as well as a national perspective to this debate. And after 50 years of HIDB and Highlands and Islands Enterprise, we feel there is a strong role for what we've done in terms of regional and community development. But working to ensure that what we do from the region contributes to that national picture. And that's really important about how we make sure that our strategy joins up. And working with partners, for example, with SDS on a regional skills plan, that was discussed in some detail at the Convention of the Highlands and Islands yesterday. So a real opportunity to explore at that regional basis how national partners, national agencies can contribute to the ongoing development of a region. Within the way we operate within Highlands and Islands, we also have a number of area offices so that we can respond directly to the needs of our rural and island communities and our small towns, so that there is even a level below that region where we can see local economies operating, and the needs and opportunities of those local economies can be quite different.
Thank you. I'm wondering if Gordon McGuinness wanted to contribute at this point on this specific question.
Yeah. I think in our work we have recognised the differences across regions in terms of economic performance, where some of the challenges are and where the opportunities lie. We did commit and have developed regional skill assessments which look at and we've worked in conjunction with other agencies in terms of developing these. So looking at where the economic opportunities are, looking at what the supply side through the colleges and universities are delivering, and looking at demographics within areas. We've committed, and so working with local authority partners in areas like the Glasgow City Deal, we're working there to produce a regional skill and investment plan. So working with the college structures in Glasgow, thinking around curriculum planning and development. And we're also working in Aberdeen in the North East in terms of looking at a regional skill investment plan there. Charlotte mentioned the work that we've done across the Highlands and Islands. So a kind of umbrella plan which was published October 2014, identifying the kind of key issues around things like depopulation, the demographic profile of issues and some of the skill challenges that have been faced by particular sectors. And we were updating the Convention of Highlands and Islands yesterday in progress against that. So I think there is a lot of joint development work there. We have seen in recent years the emergence of city deals, and you referenced the issue. So we've been working along with Scottish Enterprise with the three local authorities around their growth deal and how that's developed, building on their strengths around manufacturing, but particularly around aerospace. So I think there's ways that we can work and develop the system. Sometimes I think the funding sources need to be a bit more agile to meet local needs more effectively, but that's something that hopefully through the review process we'll be able to discuss.
Do you think that structurally speaking there's no need for enterprise agencies at a more local level because you can work with local authorities in local areas or regions? Or how would you view that?
From a skills perspective, and with a skills agency, I think we've got a good blend of national approaches for the apprenticeship programme, but then local responsiveness. Our work at a local authority level, we have school service level agreements with every head teacher in our schools, which define how we'll deliver the service internally, and we're involved in community planning at a local level. As I said, I think you have seen the emergence of things like the work in Ayrshire in terms of the growth deal, but I think potentially different approaches are being offered and taken, and that's something I think that we're open to working on. In terms of the enterprise agencies, there was obviously work with Scottish Enterprise for about 19 years, so I think when the local enterprise companies, in terms of that regional focus, changed, then perhaps the local authorities felt they were missing something of that regional dimension. But I don't think either the Scottish Enterprise or ourselves, in terms of what we've done with Ayrshire, we've been found lacking in terms of how responsive we've been to that.
Right. Linda Hannah.
If I can add, the work that we've been doing in Ayrshire, and absolutely, as you've said, has kind of looked at what does Ayrshire need to do across the three different local authorities. And having worked in Ayrshire for many years, I was based in the Lek in Ayrshire for a long time. The three geographies and the three areas have quite different needs and have quite different assets in terms of what that means for the local economy, but also the contribution that makes from Scotland. I think that blend that we've got of being able to look across the agencies and working particularly with SDS around Ayrshire, really thinking about the national assets that are in Ayrshire. So when we think of the life sciences opportunity that there is based around Irvine, looking at what Scotland can compete on globally, based around the work that we're doing with GSK and others. Also looking at, as Gordon said, aerospace and the spaceport potential around Prestwick, and about thinking about that broader manufacturing. We've been taking the work that we're doing around the Manufacturing Action Plan and supporting that around Ayrshire. But it's on the basis of what Ayrshire needs, about working with the local authorities, and the work that we've done has also been around together building that kind of team approach, so Team Ayrshire, Team North Ayrshire, and about building the capability around the business advisors that are working with companies, whether that's through Scottish Enterprise, the local authority, or the Business Gateway. And we've worked very actively around how do we make that seamless. And as a result of that, for example, in North Ayrshire, we're working with more companies now through the Gateway Growth Pipeline, through the services that we deliver directly, and the account managed portfolio. So we're seeing that beginning to really kind of bear fruit around how do we work together around that, but at the same time be able to connect that to some of the bigger opportunities at a national level and how that plays out on an international stage.
And would the same considerations to a certain extent apply to the larger cities such as Glasgow and Edinburgh, or is that a different kettle of fish?
No, absolutely. We have an approach where we've got location directors working across each of the local authority areas, so a key member of staff who works with the local authority, but we also have a regional approach, if you sense, around that. So, for example, I work very closely with Tay Cities, so around the Tay Cities deal, working with our partners around what is that deal going to look like, what are the best opportunities for Tayside, and how ambitious that we are as partners around that. And that also applies in Glasgow and Edinburgh and the other regions like Aberdeen.
Thank you. And I think Gordon MacDonald wanted to ask a question that might fit in at this point, unless, Andy, there was something specific you wanted to come in on there.
Yes, thanks, Convener. In the Enterprise and Skills Review, it talks about recognising the distinctiveness of the Highlands and Islands and retaining an agency which is locally based, managed and directed there, and also this new one for the south of Scotland. But what about the rest of Scotland? It seems that it doesn't recognise the distinctive challenges of Tayside or the west of Scotland or the northeast of Scotland. Is this not an opportunity to really embed the local approach more universally? I'm interested in, will Scottish Enterprise change its name to become Central and Northeast Enterprise, or how is Scottish Enterprise going to fit into this structure where they're identifying really just two distinctive regional approaches?
So those are all matters for phase two in terms of what needs to be looked at. So from our perspective in Scottish Enterprise, we believe that there is still absolutely a focus on the economy, the national. So being able to look at that national, regional and local perspectives are really quite important. We believe in those other areas like Tay Cities that I've mentioned. There's already mechanisms in place for us to do that. So what we're really keen to do is really focus on what needs to be done in the economy. Let's keep focused on that. Let's work with our partners to make sure that we deliver on those things and ensure that that is delivering right onto the ground in terms of the work with our customers and partners. So around, I think, something like you mentioned, kind of Tayside, I think the Tay Cities deal is the place for us to be kind of having those conversations and about making sure that we join that up with the private sector.
And Douglas Duff, did you want to come in there?
Yeah, maybe just to add in terms of the Business Gateway, our approach to localisation, which has been very much the message since the service transferred to local authorities, it was with the intent to localise better, and I think we've been able to achieve that in embedding Business Gateway services alongside the variety of services that councils offer and attune those services to local economic priorities. So they do fit in with the direction of community planning and local economic strategies. I think more recently, since 2008, they have been aggregated up to these regional levels. We've seen a number of the city deals, the growth accelerators, etc. I think there has been a petition through this round of the review to see a more seamless structure to how regional and local priorities are set across the country, so there is a clearer pattern of how those priorities are dealt with. But in doing so, make sure that we have the proper blend of being properly attuned to local circumstance, which, you know, there is expertise already at the local level in the councils, and draw on the national economic priorities, which focus on the significant areas for growth. And again, it's about marshalling the efforts of partners to achieve those.
Thank you. And Linda Hannah.
It was just really to add to that point, Douglas must have read my mind, just around aggregation and about national priorities. So it's absolutely important that we're able to respond regionally and locally, but there, you know, Scotland is a small open economy. We're competing on a world stage. We're competing very hard with international investment, not just around inward investment, but talent and investment that comes into Scotland. And we have real capability, and there is an opportunity to maintain the capability we've got in some of the kind of key sectors that we've got, but around building capability that is emerging, for example, around kind of data and subsea and other things that are emerging from the oil and gas industry and other things. So it's about having that blend of nationally how we compete, how that enables our country to be able to compete in an ever challenging economy, and at the same time make sure that the opportunities for that are spread across the country, and that we support those kind of local economies as well. So it is very important, I feel, that in terms of that national perspective in the economy, that we keep a focus on where is our future of economy going, how are we going to drive that productivity, and how do we make sure that that then flows through at a regional and local level to where companies are based and people are based and assets are being built. It's about both of those things.
Okay, thank you. Gordon MacDonald.
Yeah, I wanted to ask a question in relation to the local and national agencies working together, etc. There's obviously been comments and some of the evidence that we've saw from companies that there is lack of clarity and lack of partnership working in their view. That's the perceived the perception. But one of the things I was interested in was Scottish Enterprise's evidence, where you recommended a reduction in the number of economic development groups and forums across Scotland. Can you expand on that? You know, why and who are you particularly aiming at?
So one of the reasons that we shared that in our submission was around trying to think much more practically around action-orientated things. And I think over time there's been a kind of a growth of lots of kind of bodies or kind of groups being put together. And one of the things we've been quite reflective of, and I hear it because I sit around the Tayside Regional Advisory Board, is the challenge that the private sector has to support these numbers of bodies that exist. So we were just quite reflective, and we just made a recommendation that we thought if, you know, you could pull back on some of that and also do some of them quite differently. So rather than having fixed bodies in place, groups, whatever you want to call them, for a, you know, over, you know, they put in place and then they kind of remain forever, that you do something that's a bit more kind of agile. So you would have a focus on a particular issue, you would bring people together to address that, and then that group would come apart. And we just wondered, and it was merely a recommendation, that we thought that actually might bring some kind of different benefits. We see that around other kind of things that happen like that, and we just wondered if that actually might be of benefit. And I think part of the clutter that sometimes businesses see is there is lots of groups. So if we think of, you know, at a local level, for good reason, you know, they grow up, you know, from the bottom up, but sometimes that kind of causes that kind of perception. And we just wondered if there was a way to kind of think through that and just genuinely focus on the outcomes.
Looking at other countries of a similar size to Scotland, you know, New Zealand, Ireland, etc., are there any agencies or any of those countries of a similar structure to the way that we deliver support to businesses? Or is it less cluttered than other countries, or do they have the same number of agencies that deal across the piece?
So the skilling report that was produced as part of the work for the Enterprise Review, and hopefully members of this committee have seen that, actually undertook some of those international comparisons. And I think it probably gives us a bit of a mixed picture, in that there are elements of some of those other countries that we could probably learn from, but in other cases we could say actually what we have in Scotland looks better than some of that. I think those international comparisons are helpful to enable us to benchmark ourselves and see, are there some opportunities to improve the way that we do things? But in some cases, it actually gives us the opportunity to reflect that in some cases we are actually starting from quite a good place in terms of how we are structured within Scotland. So if members have had a chance to have a look at that report, it really does give some useful comparisons.
Okay, thanks.
Dean Lockhart.
Thank you, convener, and thank you to the guests for coming along this morning. My question relates to one of the core elements of the government's economic strategy, that is innovation and productivity. Based on international comparisons, the Scottish economy remains in the third quartile of productivity performance, behind the rest of the UK, Ireland and countries like Denmark. Based on the Scottish Enterprise submission, this productivity mismatch comes at significant cost. I believe that the estimate is £45 billion to the Scottish economy. If we reach the target of being in the first quartile, the Scottish economy would be boosted by £45 billion. Can I ask the guests, what is causing this productivity gap, and what specific measures can we take to address this? Because this is a long, long structural issue that has been facing the Scottish economy for a long time. And I guess a related question is innovation. We have world-class universities with world-class research and innovation at university, but we're not seeing the commercialisation of this innovation coming through to the economy. Is there something wrong with the transition mechanism?
Thank you very much, John. So you're absolutely right. At the heart of all of this for our economy is how can we improve our productivity? We know that that's the puzzle, that if we get that right. And it's not alone for Scotland. You know, it's the same across the UK and other parts of the world. So this goes absolutely the heart of how do we drive our economy and how do we drive benefit for all the kind of communities and people and businesses that we've talked about. In terms of things that are contributing to that, we know that our exporting performance as a country is below what it would need to be if we were going to be in the top quartile of productivity. One of the estimates that we've got is if we were to, and the region would be the UK as opposed to the OECD, but if we were in the top quartile around exporting, we would have another 5,000 or 6,000 businesses who would be exporting to be able to reach that. We know in the context of innovation that would need, you know, another kind of about 1,500 businesses to be able to do that, and we're making progress around some of those things. But we know that the scale of that is something that in terms of our economy is quite considerable. And we also know that in terms of businesses per head of population is quite considerable in terms of we would need another 120,000 registered businesses in Scotland. So we know that there is challenges around in terms of the productivity, the structure and size of the business base in Scotland, and that's been an issue that's been persistent over a long period of time, and the work with our colleagues in Business Gateway around, you know, getting more businesses to start, get them to grow, keep on growing is something that, you know, certainly when I was involved in the Business Gateway has been a mantra for quite a long time, but is challenging. And whilst we're seeing an increased number of self-employment businesses, we're not seeing them growing to the size that would start to innovate and export and create some of the kind of contribution to productivity we would look at. So going back to, you know, it is about how do we get more innovation, how do we get more exporting, how do we get more companies to invest in R&D, and overall, how do we get much more investment into the economy. So those are all things that we're working on, but we need to do much more. And you're absolutely right, you know, excellent academic expertise that we've got in our universities. And the challenge is around how do we get businesses to invest much more around R&D, how do we get them to invest much more around taking new products to market and particularly then getting them into export markets. So those are the things that we need to concentrate on, and very much would welcome that in the context of where we go next, that those are the things at the heart of the actions that we need to take.
I think all of our guests, or at least the majority of them, want to come in though, so perhaps start with Charlotte, right?
Well, I was just going to add to something on productivity before John maybe goes on innovation, and I certainly endorse the remarks regarding the sort of structural difficulty we have in terms of the size of our business base, even more so for the Highlands and Islands, and in terms of the sectoral mix, that is predominated by sectors such as tourism and food and drink, which traditionally are not as high paying as some of the other sectors. But the other point I just wanted to introduce into the discussion about productivity is also about the productivity of our human capital, and that one of the aspects of how we perform in the Highlands and Islands that we've often looked at and is a challenging issue to deal with is that of underemployment. And that is actually making it more difficult for our population to be productive as well. So working with developing the University of the Highlands and Islands is really critical to us and being able to deliver that aspect. So that I think it's helpful maybe for the committee also to look at productivity in the round. So as well as, you know, outputs and inputs in terms of a traditional way of looking at productivity, there is also a wider view in terms of its impact on communities and people and population. And I'd say that underemployment is a key thing we have as a challenge.
Thank you. Before I bring Douglas Duff in, I think possibly Gordon MacDonald wanted to come back in to slightly nuance his question or follow-up.
I just wanted to ask a question about the productivity. The Skilling report says the OECD note that productivity across the developed world has been in secular decline over the past 15 to 20 years. With that background, I noticed from High's submission that the Highlands and Islands ranked 32 out of 40 UK regions for productivity in 1997, and by 2014 it had risen to 18th, the largest change in ranking of any region in the UK. So is there anything that the other agencies can learn from the remit of High that should be reflected in the other agencies to try and gain that same level of increase in productivity?
So we'd very much welcome the opportunity as part of phase two to examine that. I suppose one of the things that's made a difference to those figures is actually the starting place. So the starting place for the Highlands and Islands was obviously a lot lower than the rest of Scotland. And we see that as a fantastic achievement for the Highlands and Islands, and hopefully the work of High is part of that. And that reflects a growth in GVA. However, that GVA still does lag behind the rest of Scotland and therefore the rest of the UK. Therefore, we still feel we have a journey to go on. But we do feel that we can bring something to the debate, particularly about what a South of Scotland agency might look like, as how we can support from that 50 years of knowledge and experience that we have.
Douglas Duff, I think, wanted to come in.
It's just a brief point to add to the work that Business Gateway does in that field to boost innovation and productivity, that our growth pipeline is very much intended to help companies move along that growth path and to access the specialist advice and support to be more innovative, to be more productive, to access international markets, to ease their scope to employ. So all of that is very much designed to achieve that growth. And to point to the work that was done recently to augment the Business Gateway services with some European funding that provides more dedicated support in these areas, so we can offer more expert help assistance to companies that will help them to examine and look at the possibilities there and lead them on to the more specialist support that Scottish Enterprise and others can offer.
I'll come to Gillian Martin, I think, has a question relating to this area.
Follow up, I suppose, from what Dean Lockhart was asking about productivity, and a couple of things were mentioned there. You mentioned that there's, a deficit in the amount of businesses being set up in order for us to reach our full potential. And I should, for the record, say that I'm a convener of the Women in Enterprise cross-party group. And we heard from one of our colleagues, it was Laura Galloway from Heriot Watt University, that she's seeing that sort of female graduates and STEM subjects in particular, a lot of them really end up in business, but they end up in business out with their skill set. They end up doing things like setting up a bed and breakfast or going into creative industries or whatever. And there is a sort of a criticism that we're missing a trick with our graduates where we could actually be involved more in universities and colleges at the point at which people are graduating and encouraging them and giving them the support to actually look at enterprise as an option rather than employment. And I just wondered if I could have some feedback on that.
Support that kind of encouragement for graduates. We fund that there are a variety of organisations that work with universities and colleges in supporting that. Probably the core one that we fund is the Scottish Institute for Enterprise, which works with pretty much every university in Scotland and around about 6,000 students a year on exactly that kind of thing, encouraging them to see enterprise as a potential route after university, and it runs competitions and boot camps and so on, and it fits in with other competitions such as the Converge Challenge, and so some of which we do alongside the enterprise agencies. Now, that is aimed at students across a whole range of disciplines, because it's often that what will turn people on to business isn't exactly the thing that they're studying at university. It's not as simple as people go to university, study a course and setting up a business and then set up a business. The people who leave university and either set up businesses very quickly or sometimes years later, it tends to be in a whole range of subjects, sometimes related. That actually, some of the winners of the competitions lately have been medical students and so on. So people you wouldn't anticipate having an entrepreneurial bent. So it's something we do need to support. Can I come back to the innovation point that we're, I politely let Linda in and then they moved on. Just to answer very quickly on that, there is a huge imbalance between the research that's done in universities in Scotland and how strong that is compared to the amount that's done in businesses. And there is an issue about how the research in universities translates into economic development in Scotland. We have funded in the last few years a set of innovation centres which sit between universities and business, and in order to help bridge that gap. There was a recent evaluation of that which was very positive, but it's early days and it's something we need to do more of. And it's an area where, as part of this review, the phrase cluttered landscape has occurred more than most, because it can be confusing for businesses knowing how to interact, probably less so with universities, but with the wide range of things that are partly university, partly enterprise agency, partly other agencies. So that is an area where better signposting and a degree of rationalisation might be the way forward. But it's very much a live issue and one that the innovation centres are trying to address.
Linda Hannah, I think, did you want to come in? Or I'll go to Charlotte Wright first.
I'm just going to go back to Gillian Martin's question to say, I think one of the most powerful things we can do is give strong role models and case studies of women in business and enterprise. So working with organisations like Women in Enterprise or with the companies that we account manage, where we can demonstrate that is a really good career track for women is something that we need to do, and we do need to find more role models and do more to make sure that people can see that, and that we share those case studies and people can see that there is a really exciting career prospect in business for women.
Women aren't the only demographic in which there's maybe a sort of an enterprise gap. So I'd be interested to see what other demographics you believe you've identified as having, and not so much a productivity gap, but an enterprise gap. Who are the sections of society that are maybe there's the wins to be gained of encouraging them into business?
The Scottish Institute for Enterprise, who I mentioned there, don't just deal with women, that covers both men and women. But we've expanded their work recently to cover colleges as well as universities, because that often the people who are studying in colleges will leave to set up their own businesses, and sometimes are more likely to do it than university students because of the kind of things they're studying. So that is very much a demographic that we see, if you can call college students a demographic, but it's a different group from university students. We see that as very important. We have also worked with High on some very specific things in the Highlands about supporting students as they leave university into types of enterprise and so on. So I think we're open to do more of that with other regions and other demographics when a need can be identified.
I just have one short question, Gordon. I won't take up too much time. Yeah. You might know that I'm an ex-college lecturer, and at the point at which your students are graduating, I see that there's not really much in terms of the curriculum, and I know that I'm jumping into the Education Committee remit in actually putting in the curriculum something to get students aware of how to set up a business. Would you see that as being an action point?
Yes, though what I would say, and you were a lecturer and I haven't lectured for a long time, what we've found in speaking to colleges and universities, that often if you build it into the mainstream curriculum of whatever subject it is, it doesn't work as well as having it sometimes semi-extracurricular in something like the Scottish Institute for Enterprise, because not all of the class might be turned on to that. And also the thinking through, not everyone leaves college or university and immediately sets up a business. Sometimes it's something you can encourage and then it happens a few years later. So we need to have the full spectrum of support. Sometimes it's built into the curriculum, sometimes it's available to sit alongside the curriculum in a course where it might not be of appeal to most of the students. And sometimes it's for people once they've left, and that's probably less of our things, but it's something we do work with the enterprise agencies on.
Thank you.
Thank you. Dean Lockhart wanted to come back in with a short supplementary.
Thank you, very, very briefly. Just talking about this full spectrum of support, I spent some time yesterday at Entrepreneurial Spark and spoke to a number of small companies who had benefited through the different stages of support and who were complimentary about the support available. The one gap they identified is support in getting the first win under their belt, the first contract, external validation of their product or service. Can you talk a bit about that? Because that's not really been touched on any of the papers I've seen in terms of actually getting those companies across the final hurdle to get the first win.
Maybe I could pick that up. We have a slightly different model of eSpark working in the Highlands and Islands at the moment, a virtual accelerator, just to pilot how that works in a more rural region. But I think the point you raise is a really important one, that for a business is going through that experience, it's how they actually get the follow-up and follow-on so that they can build on the experience and usually a lot of passion and commitment they've got through going through the accelerator process. So I think it's where either Business Gateway or the enterprise agency can plug into the graduates, if you like, of an accelerator process so that they can then move on to the next stage. So I think I'm agreeing to your point, really, that we need to make sure that accelerators have a clear place within a business growth strategy.
Thank you. And I'll move on to Ash Denham, who has a question about NPF, I think.
Thank you. You're probably aware that we had Audit Scotland in giving evidence to us last week, so I'd just like to pick up on a point that was raised by them. So in their report, they said that the development agencies in general were performing very well against their own agreed measures, but they felt that it wasn't possible to measure the contribution specifically to the National Performance Framework. So I'm just wondering if the panel think that's a fair assessment or not.
Charlotte Roy.
On that particular point, we did go back to Audit Scotland and thought their report was really excellent, and we appreciate the recommendations that were made. But in relation to that point, we did actually point out to Audit Scotland that the Highlands and Islands Enterprise Performance Measures, we have actually in our operating plan mapped them to the National Performance Framework so that we could demonstrate exactly that. We do have a different set of measures which we have tracked over time, and they are different because we are doing some different things, say, to our colleagues in Scottish Enterprise, and we need to be able to demonstrate that they are successful. I think the key point there was that there was a mapping across of our outcome measures to the performance framework.
Thank you. Linda Hannah.
If I can just add, we've also shared with Audit Scotland that kind of what we would call a line of sight, so National Performance Framework, what's in our business plan, and the published measures that we set out in that business plan, and then a kind of a broader measurement framework that we've got in SE around the things that we track and monitor, and the direct line of sight and the contribution that we believe makes to that. So we've also, as has Hai, shared that with Audit Scotland.
Okay. Thank you. Douglas Duff.
Just to, again, add very, very briefly that through the work of SLADE, the National Economic Development Body, we've been working with the Improvement Service to aggregate a set of performance indicators for economic development services at local level. That can be aggregated up to national level, so Business Gateway is an important component to that, but it does respect the other economic development services that councils provide. And certainly we'd be happy to look at the relationship of those indicators and the national ones.
So I was just going to say that in the report, they've suggested the Northern Ireland's approach for monitoring progress against the strategy to be good practice. So they're talking in here about things like publishing details of how the strategy is developed, or annual action plans, regularly reviewing progress with annual monitoring, etc. Do the panel think that that's worthwhile to do that, or is it going to add anything?
I think we recognise both from the Audit Scotland report and actually the first phase recommendations from the Enterprise and Skills Review that actually is a critical outcome there, that we get a much better and clearer join-up between national strategy and outcomes and the actions that we as agency or others undertake to deliver on them. So absolutely, I think that join-up is there to be made much more clearly.
Thank you.
Would any other panel member like to comment on that?
Well, the question was specifically about the enterprise agents and the Audit Scotland view, but on that point about annually publishing data and performance, we do publish a summary of the outcome agreement data for the colleges and universities, which is, you know, a strong proxy for the performance of our organisation. We do publish that annually, both at an aggregate level and, you know, an individual college level. So there are ways of doing that.
Linda Hannah.
Just to add to what Charlotte said, those are things that will be looked at in phase two. So I think just in terms of making sure that they think through in terms of what that looks like, or in the action plan and the measures, and that could absolutely brings that simplicity that we've talked about earlier and the direct line of sight nationally, regionally and locally. That's all very important. I think the other thing for me in all of this is always around learning about, there was a question earlier about what works, so how do you learn from that? We were very pleased that the Audit Scotland drew out the work that certainly that we and other agencies have done around our evaluation. So that kind of piece around looking at the plan and looking at the measures is also helping us to understand where we make investments, where is that making a difference, and then how do we do more of that, and how do we respond to how our economy is changing. So that kind of piece that's around that action plan and the targets and measures, I think, also helps us to kind of keep honing around what's working for us. We see around productivity, what's working for us is the join up around leadership support, workplace innovation, internationalisation and innovation. It's not about doing these things separately, it's about working with the business around their ambitions to do that, and about when you blend those things, you get quite exciting things in companies. So it's about how those things work, and I think the more that we can do that, I think that the more that gives us confidence about how we take forward different aspects in the economy.
thank you. And Jackie Bailey, did you have a follow-up to that?
Yes, just a slight tangent, if I may, Convener, because obviously the government has made clear its commitment to encouraging women into business because of the increased economic contribution that would make to GVA, something like, I think, 13 billion was the assessment. So I'm curious to pursue the second recommendation from the review, which was about the data gap, but specifically in terms of gender disaggregated statistics, because we've been told there's a paucity of statistics overall, and within that, there's definitely a paucity of gender disaggregated statistics. And I ask that in light of, you know, Scottish Enterprise's own contribution in their annual report that said that they worked with, of the high growth companies, 3% were led by women. And whilst I welcome the transparency, I'm, you know, shocked at the small number that are there. I don't know the number for high. Maybe that's different. And I just wondered if you think that gender disaggregated statistics might help in addressing some of those problems.
Linda Hannah.
Take that question first. So I agree we do need the data that helps us to kind of pinpoint what's actually happening, where is that working, what else can we be doing. I'm not sure where that 3% figure came from, so apologies. So I will kind of pick that up when I go back to the office. But partly I think the challenges around different ownership models mean that it's sometimes actually quite hard to know in terms of female ownership or female, you know, the kind of ownership of the business and what that looks like and how we gather that. So that is something that we look at. What we have looked at is we do equality monitoring for companies who approach us and access services for the first time. That isn't just account management, that's on everything that we do. So we do collect that data, and where that answer is available, the proportion of companies that are female owned a couple of years ago was around 46%. So we know it's much higher. We also know for the examples that we've got on the ground of companies that we work with, we know that we are working with companies who are female owned, but being able to pull out those statistics, I agree, gives us a sense of data and how we're able to kind of focus on that.
Kai, how many high growth companies they work with that are led by women?
I don't have that figure to hand, but we'll certainly look that out for you. What we do though is make sure that we undertake equality monitoring of all of the programmes that we run to make sure that there is nothing built in to the way that we address a programme which could actually be a barrier, be it to women or any other group. So that's a key part of the way that we would look at introducing any new programme of enterprise support. But I'll certainly look into that figure for you. I guess it's not going to be as high as we would like it to be.
Okay. And I wonder whether I might ask Douglas Duff what data collection is going on at business gateways, because there are some anecdotal stories that suggest it's not consistent and, you know, the people aren't necessarily looking at gender as an issue.
I think, as with my colleagues, I'm happy to get more statistics on that, you know, so to get the details. It is a common CRM system, as I say, so there is an initial, you know, data capture of the profile of participants in our programmes. It would be gathering that and producing some analysis for you. But certainly, the work of Women into Enterprise and programmes that are around that are, you know, vitally important in Business Gateway, and Gateway advisors do support and promote these events. And actually, in recent years, I think there has been significant growth in amongst women moving into business. They seem to be very keen networkers, and you know, that's certainly something that is seen as an important part of building a business community locally, and that itself adds to the scope for growth. So we certainly see a huge appetite amongst women in business to work together to ensure that they're getting the best quality of service. Our Gateway advisors working closely with them to enable growth to take place and to enable that to move forward. But happy to get the stats.
That's very helpful. I wonder whether the account managers or Gateway advisors, whether they have any gender-specific training. I'm getting two nods.
Yeah.
Yes, if I can add to that, we absolutely provide as part of the CPD work. We do the training for account managers. That does include gender, and that also includes, as Charlotte said, we make sure that we check and that it's baked into all our services, that there is nothing that's actually going to get in the way of that. But we also make sure that we're thinking about, in terms of what that training needs to look like going forward, what needs to change on the back of the feedback that we're getting from companies that are female-led around anything that might have made a difference around those things.
John Mason wanted to come in.
Just to follow in on that, I mean, I think Gillian Martin mentioned other groups as well, as we've emphasised women a lot, which is great. Disabled people and maybe people from ethnic minorities, because we have seen figures that people from ethnic minorities are doing better, they're doing more higher education and are coming out better qualified, but aren't doing so well employment-wise.
And I could add unemployed Scottish white males from disadvantaged areas.
Sorry, I'm not sure who we're addressing the question to. We certainly wouldn't have that information initially to hand, and some of it might be quite difficult to obtain if that's a question about how many people are in account management or receive our products and services. Some EU programmes require certain questions to be asked, but they are anonymised and would be at a programme level.
OK.
Gordon McGuinness.
Skills perspective, our challenges are slightly different, and particularly around occupational segregation, but we've spent a good amount of time working with partners, particularly from specialist groups, to develop our modern apprenticeship action plan, and within that it obviously looks at gender, but also looks at black and ethnic minority participation, people with disabilities and care leavers who are disadvantaged within the labour market. It's a four-year plan, fixed milestone, so working hard with partners around the delivery of that.
Linda Hanna.
If I can add one more thing around the kind of focus that we've got around inclusive growth, a big part of that is around workplaces, so about what happens within the companies that we work with. A lot of that is around thinking about job design. It's about thinking about how job is organised, jobs are organised, what that means in terms of different kind of structures, and encouraging employers to think about the workplace practices that might encourage them to be able to access the talent that's going to be best for their business and the mix of that. So sometimes that could be around part-time working, it could be around disabled workers, it could be around using digital mechanisms to do that, or flexible working. It could be around busting myths. Sometimes we've heard, certainly anecdotally, that certainly females particularly might have a view that in a manufacturing environment you wouldn't be able to do a job because it has to be, you know, kind of full-time, whereas that's not the case. So it's also about then working with employers to go out to their communities and actually talk about some of those kind of things, be engaged in schools, be engaged in with colleges, and be engaged in their community around kind of bringing forward some of those models. And then hopefully what that brings is some of those kind of opportunities in a different way. And what we've certainly seen with employers that we work with in that way, that they see a big difference. Sometimes that's about youth, sometimes it is about disabled workers, sometimes it's about different parts of the community. And I think increasingly, going back to the regional dimension, we've been talking and quite thoughtful with Scottish Government, not just around the asset piece of the kind of regional economic development, but also thinking about the kind of social inclusion dimension of that, so the inclusive growth diagnostic, and around when there isn't the kind of talent pool coming through for those employers, what's stopping that, and therefore how do we match together the work that we're doing with companies, the work that's happening in colleges and others, to make sure we've got that kind of skills flow coming in and that that's meeting the demands of employers. So I think there's a bigger piece around that we've been doing a bit of work on, we need to do much more work on, but I think we'll start to kind of bring through some of that kind of data and intelligence around where we need to focus a bit more.
Dr. Kemp.
Yeah, we recently published our gender action plan, which was originally something that was asked for as part of the developing the young workforce report, but we expanded it to include universities as well. And that seeks to address some of the issues that we've talked about today. We recognise that there's quite a complex issue that while in colleges about 50% of the students are from each gender, there's huge segregation in which particular courses they study. Some courses are almost entirely male, some almost entirely female. There's a separate issue at higher education where, as well as having gendered courses, female participation is higher than male participation, similar to the point you made about young white males in some ways not doing as well out of the education system. So we are trying to work with employers and with others and through our outcome agreements to balance some of these. But there are other groups as well. Gender is the one we prioritised this year, but there's been quite a lot of activity recently on care leavers as well, and we've been building widening access for care leavers into our outcome agreements over recent years as well. And that will be something that Commission for Widening Access work as it goes forward and very much address.
Right, thank you. I'd like to go on to Richard Leonard, who has a question, I think, to do with budget and forward planning, but I'll let him ask the question.
Yeah, thanks, Convener. It's principally for Charlotte Wright and Linda Hannah, but I would welcome the contributions and observations of the other witnesses. In the weeks that lie ahead of us, one of the tasks of this committee will be to consider the Scottish Government's budget, and especially the Scottish Government's budget as it affects enterprise and skills and economic development. The Audit Scotland report, which we received evidence on last week, spoke about the 16% in real terms cut of the Scottish enterprise budget between 2008-2015 and the 22% cut in the operational budget of Highlands and Isles Enterprise over that same period. The Cabinet Secretary, in his foreword to the review last week, used one of his favourite expressions, which is that any change needed to be cost effective. In light of that, I just wonder whether you would help us understand how we are resourcing the increase in the creation of a Board of Trade. Trade envoys being dispatched across Europe, Scottish Development International staff doubling, I think. I also wonder, especially Linda Hannah, if you would reflect on the submission from Scottish Enterprise where you ambitiously recommend that the number of companies that Scottish Enterprise helps grows from between 2,000 and 3,000 to between 10,000 and 15,000, a 500% increase. Is that based upon, and is the work you're now being asked to undertake on this internationalisation in the face of Brexit, are you receiving additional resources for that? Do you expect to get a significantly enhanced budget in the round that's coming up or not?
Charlotte Wright.
Well, shall I go first? I wonder if there's just a context around about Audit Scotland firstly as well that I'd maybe just like to give you a bit more of an information around. So they focused on the grant and aid element of budget, which is the bit that we get directly from government. We do augment that budget. So for 2015-16, whilst our actual budget was 66 million, we delivered a spend of 111 million as we brought in money from Europe that we realised income from our own assets. And we also got additional funds for specific programmes such as Community Land Fund, Community Broadband Scotland and Wave Energy Scotland, which added considerably to that. So there's always maybe a bit of context around about that. Having said that, I think we're probably realistic about what the future looks like budget-wise, and part of this review is clearly about making sure that we're all as efficient and effective as we can be. I would love to hope that there was more budget coming our way. I think our expectation is that we need to make sure that we're as effective as we can in terms of delivery. A great way into that is looking at how we can use digital better to give a better reach to our clients, and that we're actually quicker in turning over our interaction with clients so that we can be sharper and more focused in those engagements so that we can perhaps reach a wider population of the business base.
Linda, Hannah?
So if I can add to that. So certainly, as Charlotte said, beyond the grant and aid that we get from Scottish Government, we absolutely are focused as a team around maximising our income. Some of that comes from our property disposals, our investment income, as well as EU income, as Charlotte says. And in any given year, we are absolutely seeking to do everything we can to make sure that we invest what needs done for the Scottish economy and focus our resources in the right places around what needs to be done. And over the last number of years, that's exactly what we have done. If I think of it even in the last couple of years around the shifts that we've made around responding to what's happened in oil and gas and what's happened in the Northeast, and about shifting resource around those things. So even within the model that we currently have, we've kind of made sure that, you know, where there are needs in the economy, that we've responded to that, and at the same time made sure that we're effective around some of the other things that we sought to do. And we've made quite a lot of savings, I think, over the last number of years that has allowed us to kind of help to do that. Like Charlotte, I'd love to think that we were going to get even more money, but I think we're all realistic just in terms of where we are right now in the public purse. And what's really important is that we use the funding and the resources that we've got really wisely, and that we make the right investment decisions. And we're pleased that the Audit Scotland report kind of talked about the risks that we take and how that we are very careful about the decisions that we make around getting the best return for the economy. And that's exactly the approach that needs to take place going forward. Clearly, there are going to have to be trade-offs. Unless there is going to be lots more resources, there will be trade-offs that will need to be made. And again, I think in phase two, I think thinking through how do we make through those decisions together, where are we able to work together or collaborate that actually allows us to do even more if we can with the resources that we've got, I think will be increasingly important. And certainly the piece that we've put in around working with many more companies, we are very ambitious around using digital mechanisms to do that. So, you know, when I think of going back to when I was involved in Business Gateway 10 years ago, we really at that time wanted to have a blended service about digitally enabled services, but the market wasn't ready for it. But the world has moved on quite considerably now, and I think businesses are much more ready and actually interested in being able to have services digitally delivered so that they can use that. And we believe that we think that provides opportunities to reach many more businesses with some of the services that might currently be provided in a particular way that we think can be augmented to provide even more value for the public purse. So we're investing heavily in that right now, in that kind of digital capability. So not taking the existing services and putting them online, but actually designing services for a digital world. So, and we do think that that will enable us to reach many, many more companies.
Right. Very brief follow-up, Richard.
So the answer to the question about how you're going to reach five times as many companies is digitalisation, or do you envisage employing more account managers? And on the SDI, the doubling of SDI staff, is that new people coming into the organisation? Is that a redeployment of existing staff members?
So I'll take the last piece first. So in terms of the four-point plan that was announced, we are still in discussion with Scottish Government about what that looks like, and that's certainly something that my colleagues in SDI are discussing with Scottish Government. So I don't have an answer for you on what that looks like, because we're still involved in having those conversations about what that means. And certainly in terms of the reaching more customers, a portion of that will be around digital. What needs to then supplement that digital, we've still to kind of work through in terms of what that means, particularly in terms of whether that's account management or about specialist services or about collaboratively how we work across partners. Those are things that we have been ambitious and set out in our submission, but we still to work through what the detail of that would look like.
Thank you very much. Well, I'm afraid our time has gone, so I'd like to thank all of our guests for coming today. Thank you very much, and I'll now suspend the meeting for a comfort break, and we'll reconvene at 11 o'clock. Thank you very much. Well, good morning and welcome to everyone. This is our roundtable discussion on economic impact of leaving the European Union. I would like to welcome the witnesses and just say that you don't need to press your speak buttons or anything. If you indicate to me by simply raising your hand that you'd like to come in on a question or discussion, simply do so by raising your hand and I'll bring you in, and broadcasting will deal with the mics. It's a sort of formal-informal setting, I suppose, and an informal roundtable set up meant to facilitate discussion between the committee members and the witnesses. And I wonder if we could simply go round from my right, starting with Dr. Graham Roy, and if you could simply introduce yourself and indicate the organisation you're from. And I think Jenny Stewart from KPMG could be given an opportunity just to explain a small bit about her role in that organisation, because I think you've been added to the list of witnesses slightly later than the others and not had the opportunity to put in a written statement. So I'll start with Dr. Roy.
Yep, thank you very much for the invitation to come along this morning. My name's Graham Roy. I'm the director of the Fraser Islander Institute at the University of Strathclyde.
I'm Richard Marsh. I'm an economist with a small independent consultancy called Four Consulting, based in Kirkcaldy.
I'm Stephen Boyle. I'm the chief economist at RBS.
Fabian Zulik. I'm the chief executive and chief economist of the European Policy Centre, which is an independent Brussels-based think tank. And I'm also on the Standing Council on Europe.
Okay, good morning. My name is Jane Gotts. I'm director of a business startup called Gen Analytics, which focuses on the area of equality and diversity in the workplace.
And I'm Jenny Stewart, partner at KPMG. I run our government business in Scotland and part of a group who run our UK public sector business. Thank you to the convener. I'll just do a quick one-minute intro, since you haven't got a paper from me. Just to say that KPMG took the vote very seriously, prepared for it, both eventualities, and within 2 days of the vote, appointed a head of Brexit, and we've been gathering intelligence from across our very diverse client base and working with clients to help them respond to the Brexit vote. So I just thought I would pick out just some key points which you might want to pick up later. I think obviously the first thing is that the immediate impact has not been as severe as was predicted. So I spend a bit of time explaining to clients why that hasn't been the case. And the quick one-second answer is there's three bits to the economy: consumer spending, 60%, business investment, and then whatever government and the Bank of England does. And effectively, consumer spending has held up. Business investment, instead of thinking we'll stop until we know more, has generally been, it's so uncertain, we don't know what's happening, so we'll just carry on as usual. And obviously the intervention by Mark Carney and the Bank of England and the reduction in interest rates was obviously pretty helpful. But in terms of Brexit itself, every business will have a different exposure to Brexit. And given the economic and political uncertainty that's around at the moment, really what businesses are doing and the work we're doing with business is really around scenario planning. So it's saying we don't know, we can't possibly predict it's exactly going to be like this or it's exactly going to be like that. What kind of broad scenarios are likely to emerge, and therefore how do we respond to that and how do we deal with that? The key business issues that they're picking up at present are obviously around people and their exposure to EU, the easiest way to describe it is EU 27 nationals. So KPMG itself, we knew before the vote exactly how many people, our 700 staff, EU 27 nationals. We then made sure that we contacted them after the vote, reassured them of their value to us as individuals within the company, and set up arrangements to provide advice to those individuals. So that's people. The other issue is strategy. So clearly, with the significant drop in the pound, then a number of companies, there's a lot of foreign direct investment coming in. Companies are becoming acquisition targets. Equally, some businesses across the UK are now revisiting their acquisition strategy in the light of the pound. So people, strategy, medium-term financial planning, really, you know, what is given the potential around exchange rates, inflation, et cetera, et cetera. Let's review our medium-term financial planning assumptions and see whether we breach our banking covenants in any of those scenarios. The other issue is tariffs. So clearly, if we do end up in a WTO situation, how is that likely to impact on that particular business, and what are the costs? So those are the kind of key business issues. Clearly, individual sectors are affected differently. And, you know, so across the EU, different countries are now making clear that they've got a competitive offer. So Slovakia, for example, in the automotive sector, are really stressing their competitiveness, and Jaguar Land Rover has just made a big investment there. Clearly, Frankfurt, Luxembourg and Brussels are... Dublin, Frankfurt and Luxembourg are making a play for financial services institutions. So in terms of the sectoral issues, there are specific sectors affected, HE, agriculture, financial services. But actually, for most businesses, it's really about what's going to happen to the economy. And the last point I just wanted to make was around what this all means for public policy. So clearly, public spending accounts in Scotland for about 40% of GDP. Directly, the public sector employs 20% of the workforce, and even more are reliant on that. So clearly, what happens in tax and spending will have a big impact on the economy. And the fiscal framework clearly will need reopening in the light of things like the cap. And then we're seeing across our client base questions beginning to be asked about, well, what is future policy going to be in those key areas like agriculture, fishing, research and development, social fund, regional policies. So these are all policy areas that the Scottish Parliament and Scottish Government will take over post-Brexit. So people are already starting to think, well, actually, what are the policy choices? How are we as individual businesses going to be affected if there is a significant policy shift? So that was that. Apologies if that was too long by way of introduction, but hopefully helpful.
Thank you very much. And may I also welcome Dr. Matthias Margulis. And you are a lecturer at the University of Stirling. Thank you for joining us. We're doing a roundtable format today. The committee members will ask questions, and if you want to come in on a discussion topic or question, simply indicate by raising your hands. A hand will do. And once that's noted, then I will seek to bring you into the discussion. So, not at all. Thank you. I will perhaps start with a question, and this is specifically directed to Richard Marsh, who has done a paper from his company For Consulting, which has been submitted to us. And it relates to the question of EU citizens and their contribution to Scotland's economy and society. And I think you say yourself in the paper that it's more looking at a snapshot rather than what may or will happen, because policy changes and how these affect people or what they do or don't do is not something you address in this document. On page 2 of that, you do say that it's difficult to measure the number of EU citizens living in Scotland and their social and economic contribution. So I'd like to ask you a few questions about the numbers in your paper, if I may. And just to start off with, you have in paragraph 1.5 on page 2 of your paper, page 2 by the numbering in our documents, but I think you'll be familiar with your own paragraphs, I'm sure. You say there are around 209,000 people who were born in EU 28 countries, accounting for around 4% of Scotland's total population. The First Minister's talked about 173,000 EU nationals living in Scotland. Can you clarify the difference between those two figures for us?
Yes, absolutely. As you've kindly pointed out already, it is actually quite difficult to measure even the number of people. So one of the big differences, and we've set it out here, is people who were born in the EU 28 countries and people who are citizens of those EU 28 countries. So we've referenced here a paper that neatly summarises that from the Office for National Statistics, the ONS. And they think that around 16% of people across the UK who are from the other EU countries have actually become UK citizens. So that would account for some of the differences between the numbers perhaps that the First Minister cited and the numbers that we show here in the report. The other
So 83% of 209,000 is roughly 173,000.
I was trying to do the maths in my head, but yeah, that's roughly about right, yeah.
And so would that explain the discrepancy between the figure in your report, the 209,000, and the First Minister's figure?
It might do. What a bit of pains to say is that the figure we've shown here is from a survey, and it's taken from a very small part of the overall population. So all the figures we show in our report are estimates, and there'll be a margin of error in those estimates. So it's plus or minus a few thousand, possibly tens of thousands around the figures that we show.
And your purpose in this paper is, correct me if I'm wrong, to show the contribution that EU citizens make to the Scottish economy. Is that correct?
Yes. I think I originally submitted this to the European Committee, and I was asked to pass on a slightly updated version to the Economy Committee. So it was to answer the two specific questions in the call for evidence from the European Committee to show the economic and social contribution of EU workers.
And you are aware that EU citizenship is not based on where a person is born. So where a person is born does not mean that they possess the nationality necessarily of that country. And the European Union framework is based on rights for European Union citizens. So a European Union citizen is such a citizen because they are a national of a member state of the European Union.
We've in the report, I think we've been fairly clear to say we're just looking at people who were born in EU countries. We haven't really gone into the issues of citizenship. The survey does include some questions. The Labour Force survey would allow us to go in and interrogate to say, would you classify yourself as a European citizen? It's a self-response survey, so we're relying on people providing accurate information.
So it doesn't necessarily give us an indication of the numbers of people who have a right to be here based on European Union citizenship.
No, absolutely not. This is purely looking at the number of people who were born in EU countries outside of the UK.
Thank you. And if we look at some EU citizens, of course, non-UK born, such as Irish citizens, they would have a right to live and work in the United Kingdom that is unrelated to their EU citizenship, would they not? Under the common travel agreement.
You're probably pressing me on an area in which I'm not an expert.
Thank you. So, Jenny Stewart.
Just to say, obviously, I talked about the EU 27. That was because we within our firm, we recognise that Irish would have a different status.
The status of Irish citizens is unaffected by whether or not the United Kingdom is in the EU, because they have rights under the Common Travel Agreement which predate the European Union rights.
That's our understanding. And yes. Why we've been
so doing. Did you look at the figures of the number of Irish citizens living and working in Scotland who on that level would be unaffected by the United Kingdom leaving the European Union?
We could, and certainly I had a quick look at the number of Irish people who were born in Ireland living and working in Scotland. The problem is the sample sizes get quite small. when you begin looking at individual countries and asking what proportion of that population are working and how much do they get paid. You're dealing with sample sizes that wouldn't allow you to produce credible results.
But if we're talking about European Union citizens who would be affected in the sense of a question of whether or not they're allowed to remain here after the UK leaves the EU, you'd have to take out the Irish citizens because they're not affected.
If you wanted to look at that, you could almost certainly take them out and the numbers presented in the report would be lower.
Now, also, if we think of the number of EU citizens who have a right to permanent residence within the United Kingdom, namely those who've been in the UK for 5 years or more, can you tell us what percentage of the numbers referred to in Scotland in your report fall into the category of having been resident here 5 years and therefore there's no question about whether or not they would have a right to remain when the UK leaves the EU?
Again, the labour force survey is it's a very useful source of information, and it does include information on what year did you arrive in the UK. So we could do that analysis and filter out those who've arrived within the last 5 years and apply it. The problem then, it becomes a slightly more in-depth piece of research that might take a little longer. But again, we could do it, and you could say, what country do you come from? Have you arrived in the last 5 years or not? That's entirely doable. And if you wanted to take a view of, instead of a snapshot, you wanted to try and address a policy question, you could try and amend the data slightly to get close to the question that you want to ask.
So if the Home Office has figures that suggest more than 80% of EU nationals living in the United Kingdom, in fact, fall into that category, is that something that could be extrapolated to Scotland in the same way that I think you've extrapolated the 16%, 83% figure from the ONS figures?
Yeah, for the ONS figures, you'd simply ask a slightly different question and say, are you a citizen of another EU country? And that would follow the ONS route. You could also try and take away certain countries, and you could also try and do another cross-tab with the tables, add another dimension, and ask, have you arrived in the last 5, 10, 20 years? All of that's doable.
My understanding is you haven't done it in this or for the purposes of this paper. And I take it then you haven't looked at the question of EU nationals who have been resident in the UK for less than 5 years, but in fact would have a right to remain because, for example, they have children born here who are British citizens.
Yeah, and you can actually extend the analysis even further if you chose to do so and say, do you have children who were born here in the UK?
And I think also you haven't looked at the question of dual nationality. So someone can be born in a European Union country, have British nationality, or be born in Britain, have nationality of a European Union country, and they would be unaffected by these changes.
Yeah, again, we focused on those born in the country, so we haven't touched citizenship and nationalities.
Right. So do I take it from what you're saying that you accept that the paper shows the contribution that people born out with Scotland in EU countries who are resident and working here make to the country, but it doesn't address the question of who would have a right to remain upon the UK leaving the EU?
Absolutely.
Thank you. Now, I think if I could move on to Gordon MacDonald has a minor question on this, I think.
Yeah, thanks very much, convener. In relation to your paper, I just wanted to ask a very quick question. Scotland, like Western Europe, has an ageing population, and we need young workers and people that want to come to this country, put down roots. And yesterday I visited a food manufacturing company who highlighted that 41% of their production staff and office and some of their office staff were obviously Eastern European and had been there for up to 10 years. While the Home Office might be putting down an agreement that people have a right to remain,
What happens in future years when we still require a workforce and we still have this ageing population? How do we attract workers if we suddenly have a barrier in place?
So a question to
myself? Yeah.
Well, I suppose what I'd do is sort of point you towards the table that we produce looked at, as best we could, some very broad sectors of Scotland's economy. We looked at manufacturing, and the proportion of people employed in manufacturing from other EU countries was slightly higher, and the wages paid to those workers in the manufacturing sector was much higher. So perhaps you have more full-time workers, perhaps they're working slightly longer hours, or they're paying a higher wage rate. We couldn't go into it. So it's around approaching 12% of the wage bill for employees is in manufacturing in Scotland is paid to people born in other EU countries. So I think I recognise the situation you've described, and in manufacturing it is a particular concern. I don't want to sound flippant in your response, but if it's more difficult to recruit people from other EU countries that has traditionally been an important source of labour, then it will become more difficult to find the workers you need.
Right. I'll come to Gil Paterson, because I think you wanted to come in on this subject, and perhaps you could also open the discussion out. I don't want to feel that Richard is being put on the spot on his own here. Gil.
The question's almost been covered, but I think we need to widen it out a bit. And my experiences in the automotive industry in Scotland, not in the UK, and I'm not talking about big plants in England that manufacture cars, and the number of people in that industry at the present time in Scotland is quite a substantial number of EU nationals within that sector, and they're very, very highly qualified. So my question is, although also in the health, so you've got the private sector and you've got the public sector and the health sector, this question relates to that also. What's the panel's view on the long-term future economic situation for Scotland if part of that workforce is removed, and it's a long term rather than the immediate 5-year threshold that may also be removed at any given time by the government?
Dr. Roy?
Yeah, I mean, I guess you start to allude to, I guess, one of the key issues and the key challenges around thinking about what the future might be in a world of where Scotland and the UK are outside the European Union. I guess the key thing about that is holding everything else constant, so assuming that nothing else changes, then we know that we have an ageing population in Scotland. We know that attracting skilled migration into the country is good for the long-term health of the economy. Most academic studies would show that. So you start to get into, you know, questions about, well, what do you do to respond to that? And as I said, all else remaining equal, something like Brexit makes this a headwind into the future, and that becomes something which, and I think we would encourage an institute, you know, particularly the committee and policymakers, to start to think about, well, what might you do within both domestic policy, and what might you do in terms of the future negotiations about the terms of Brexit, about to try and tackle something which you know is a genuine long-term challenge, which Brexit doesn't help with.
Stephen Boyle.
Pursuing the point that Graham Roy has just made, assume for a moment that at some point the existing arrangements that allow people to move freely come to an end, and that over a period of time that means that migration falls very sharply from current and recent levels to much lower levels. What we know, and I think the Fraser Valland Institute's work points to this as well, is that will mean slower growth in the Scottish economy, other things being equal. I think what then, amongst the things that points us to, is what are the other measures at our disposal? What other things could we do in a circumstance where the labour supply becomes constrained? And I would turn quite quickly to the fact that we have in Scotland still a very large proportion of the working age population that's outside the job market. So by all means, it's important to focus on the actions that you can take to try to secure a good deal around the free movement of people. but it's at least as important to try to draw more people back into the job market, because that's in a sense a form of internal migration that you could think about drawing on.
Gil, you wanted to come back.
Supplementary to that. So I'm looking at the long term, but of course, if this effect might be quite, you know, it might be quite a sharp cut-off period. So my question would be relating to the long term. How long does it take, and how do you square that circle in terms of training people in these highly skilled jobs? How long does that take? And how does that impact on the economy?
So I'm going to reach the limit of my knowledge on this quite quickly in answering you. I think the answer is it depends hugely on what the occupations are that you're dealing with. So it will be much easier and possible to do much more quickly the training that's required for some jobs than for others. And my guess, and it's no more than that, would be that for some automotive trades, it might take quite a considerable period of time, whereas for other industries and occupations it could be done more quickly. But if you get a cliff edge reduction in labour supply, then that would mean a wrenching adjustment for a lot of employers. It would push up labour costs quite sharply.
And I think
I just referenced the automotive industry. People might be more familiar with the health service and the impact on that, you know, so it's just I know all about the motor industry, that's all, sorry to say.
Right, I think Julian Martin wanted to come in with a question, then I'll come to Jenny Stewart.
Okay. We've heard reports of various dispensation, I suppose calls for dispensation from the potential of effects of Brexit an agreement with Nissan, and calls for London, the City of London, to be excluded from certain implications of Brexit, in particular access to the European single market. I'd be interested to hear from some of the people around the table on their views on whether certain sectors in Scotland should have the similar exemption from some of the implications of Brexit and what that might mean.
Come to Jenny Stewart first, because I think you possibly want to come in on the previous point, and if you want to come in on Gillian's question, then open it up to other guests on Gillian's question.
I'll leave that to others. I've spoken quite a lot, but just on that point around the workforce, clearly we don't know what future immigration policy would be, or what constraints, or who would be, what kind of visa system might respond. So that's obviously one question that will impact on the future economy. The other point I just wanted to make was more of a short-term one about how attractive Britain is then to future people coming in. We've obviously seen the pound dropping quite sharply, and I'm sure we'll maybe come on to that in the debate. But what that means for a lot of people coming in is that if they're being paid in pounds and they want to send money back home, it becomes less attractive to come to the UK than, say, Germany or France. Or equally, for non-EU people coming in, an example I use, one of our very bright economists who paid in pounds but still has student loans in the US, which suddenly costs spiralled. She was thinking about her career anyway and has moved to Australia. But so one needs to think about also how attractive we'll be, and the pound is a big issue in terms of that. Sorry.
Yes, Jane Gotts.
Yep. Can I maybe come back on the point you were making about the internationalisation and the exporting agenda? I think as a kind of overview, it's probably important to look at the challenges the Scottish economy faces in terms of our low levels of internationalisation. So I think it would be quite useful for the committee to consider that, as Graeme mentioned, in terms of what the forward projections and policy making should look like for the Scottish economy. We know the statistics in terms of Scotland's trade with the European Union. How that will be impacted in terms of Brexit, we don't yet know. Jenny referred to WTO and potential tariffs, but if we are looking at the future success of Scotland's economy longer term, we need to be much more open in terms of our businesses exporting beyond the European Union. Our exports to Asia remain very, very low. Recent exports to China, I've got the statistics, were 530 million. Recent exports to India, 228 million. Now, these are two of the most fastest growing economies in the world, and our export levels still remain very, very low. So, in terms of forward policy making, we need to look at Scotland's export strategy as a whole and actually say, why do we still have over 50% of our exports generated by 50 companies? It would be interesting if the committee could look at that in terms of how many of those 50 companies are actually foreign owned and what are the risks to the Scottish economy if these businesses were actually to decide to leave Scotland. Whether due to Brexit or not. So it's not answering your question specifically on trade agreements, but I think it's important to have that overarching look at where Scotland's exports currently are and why we still have very, very low levels of exporting amongst our business base, particularly amongst our SME business base, which remains obviously the key driver of Scotland's economy.
Dr. Roy.
Yeah. I mean, just picking up on... Gillian's point about, you know, what sectors, et cetera, come in. I mean, I guess from our thinking, I think we think that there's probably four ways to look at this going forward. One is to do what's, you know, to start to think through about what are the different trade-offs that might happen from different trade agreements, different outcomes from the UK's exit from the European Union. So the whole debate about membership of the EEA or WTO models and things like that, we think that, you know, that becomes quite important. And these will have quite unique implications for individual sectors. So it's important to understand that. So a model where you're in the EEA could be really quite different for an individual sector to one where you're in the WTO. And understanding that, the potential implications for individual sectors will be quite crucial. I think the second thing then is starting to broaden that out into how might different sectors be impacted by elements such as changes in migration rules, for example. We know that certain sectors of the economy are more dependent upon inward migration than other areas. Tourism, you mentioned the point about automotives, NHS, so understanding the potential implications there. I think the third thing then is you start to move into, well, what policy opportunities open up from no longer being part of the European Union? Now, that gets much more controversial, it's much more into the political sphere, but, you know, we know that this place is going to get further powers as a result of Brexit. There may be even further elements maybe coming through fiscal framework. So what areas within there could you potentially use policy in a different way? And that might have implications for sectors as well. And I guess the final part with all of that is really to broaden it out to say, what are the existing policies and strategies that the Scottish Government, but also the UK, but let's just focus on the Scottish Government at the moment, are taking forward to deliver their economic strategy at the moment? And, you know, it can't be the case that the delivery of the economic strategy, you know, prior to Brexit has now got to be exactly the same afterwards. There's going to be new challenges. There's going to be new opportunities there. So reassessing what the economic strategy might look like in a world where you're no longer part of the European Union, I think becomes really quite crucial as well. So what levers do the Scottish Government have under their disposal at the moment that could be used differently to have an impact on sectors? And I guess coming back to your general question, I think what our analysis and our modelling did for the Europe Committee, aside from the headline impacts, was start to look at, well, what sectors are most exposed to the European Union? So what sectors can you identify as being, well, actually, that's one we may need to be quite worried about, or we may need to think about how we respond to that. But also what other sectors maybe have other opportunities, have greater, you know, scope to move into wider international markets. And then our policy response for them might be quite different. It might be less about protecting and about nurturing and supporting a sector. And actually, how can we help them use, you know, the future growth that will happen in the global economy to tap into to wider markets? So I think it's quite complex. There's quite a lot of things in there. But I think that all of that needs to be looked at if we're going to get a comprehensive response to this.
Thank you. And Richard Marsh.
Sorry, I'm going to try and shamelessly borrow some research I did with Fabian a long time ago. But I think the point about what sectors is interesting. We've had some brilliant work from the Fraser on this. What I'd also add is the single market is much more than just workers and trade. If you look at the Financial Times today, the biggest company in America is Apple. In its top 20, I think there's six companies, Google, Microsoft, Oracle, Facebook, Amazon, that just weren't really there 10, 20 years ago. If you look at the same top 20 for Europe, there are no software companies in the top 20 for Europe. The single market is bringing together a whole series of disparate countries and trying to say, how can we have common rules around digital services, signatures, bringing all the very difficult things together. And that, in the United States, where they have a fully integrated single market, has produced global companies of scale that are world-beating. What I would say from this is it's good and proper that we think very carefully about the Scottish economy as it is today and how we can protect the sectors that are thriving now, but what do we need to put in place so we actually see some of the smaller creative technology-based companies that are actually doing really well but don't have the scale yet in Scotland? How do we put things in place to make sure they can still trade and integrate online with the rest of Europe and the rest of the world?
Thank you. And Dr. Margulis.
Thank you, Convener. I just want to address the question of the Nissan special so-called deal that's been in the news a lot. At this point, we don't really have a full picture of what the specific assurances that the government has made to Nissan, but one of the suggestions that has been made in the news is that the UK government will pursue zero tariff entry for British automobiles into the EU market post-Brexit. That would make sense on paper, given that EU tariffs on automobiles can be as high as 22%. However, the idea of special sectoral deals is not very likely to be WTO compliant. The only way you can have sort of this kind of arrangement is under a comprehensive free trade agreement, which is essentially the single market, the customs union. Outside of that kind of arrangement, you cannot provide duty-free entry for specific sectors for specific trade partners. So the likelihood of this kind of option being WTO consistent is very, very low. So I think the idea of thinking about can we have special sectoral deals with the EU is not likely to fly with international trade.
Jackie Bailey wanted to come in.
It was to pick up Jane Gott's point, because I think that there are undoubtedly challenges with exports, but there are also opportunities. And I'm struck by generally, one, an agenda that says we need to lift exports overall, but secondly, to say, actually, we do very badly in the rest of the world. So given we know the hierarchy of kind of we export more to the rest of the UK, you know, then comes, I think, Europe, and then comes the rest of the world. I'm curious to know whether you think it makes sense that the government's strategy is to expand exporting in Europe and actually not take on that bigger piece, which is the rest of the world where the opportunity lies. So I'm just curious as whether you think that should be the priority, or is there something else that the government should look at?
I mean, I think that the Scottish government have to be commended, because the reach that the Scottish government has in international markets is very good. I mean, Scotland has representation in all trading businesses anyway through the UK, but Scotland specifically has offices throughout Europe. It has offices in Asia. It has offices in the USA. So I think the infrastructure is there. I was aware of the recent announcement to actually increase Scottish presence in Berlin, I think, which I actually think is a really good thing, because the German economy is a market that offers a lot of opportunities for Scotland, again, particularly due to the Germans' very strong SME base. So I think if you were looking at trade between Scotland and Germany, focusing on SMEs, that's a positive. So what I would say is the infrastructure is there. Scottish businesses just don't seem to be taking advantage of it to the extent that they should be to grow exports. So it's not the infrastructure. I think there is still challenges within Scottish businesses in terms of getting them to internationalise for a whole host of reasons, whether it is access to finance, whether it is awareness of opportunity. I know the Scottish Chambers have done a lot of research that actually looks at businesses and they don't actually think that they have a product that can be sold overseas. However, as you say, if they're selling into England or into Ireland, they effectively are exporting. It's just about getting more of that international mentality, if you like. But also, I mean, I can understand it because of the pressures of doing day-to-day business is difficult. So it can seem very challenging to do businesses in overseas markets. It can seem that it would be an expense. However, the more that can be done to allay these concerns, I think, is very positive for the economy. But I would definitely say that the infrastructure is there. There's just not enough businesses taking advantage of it.
Could I just maybe push a little bit further? I suppose what I'm asking is, should the priority be to expand in Germany or should it be to expand in the rest of the world?
Well, I think it's a difficult question to answer yes or no to at this stage. You know, the Scottish Government has been increasing its offices in India. They have increased their offices in China in recent years. So that's obviously looking at where the Scottish Government have their priority plans in terms of the markets. I believe they're also, you know, they've expanded into South America. So I'm just aware of the recent announcement in Germany. But as I say, I would think that is a good thing based on the current German economy.
Dr. Margulis, did you want to come back in? And may I ask something about you talked about the car industry and sectoral deal. And I think, as you rightly say, we don't know what the detail of what assurances may or may not have been given. But I'm just thinking in terms of we import, I think, billions of pounds worth of cars from Germany to the United Kingdom. If the Japanese continue to have cars built in the United Kingdom after we leave the EU, those cars could be sold in the UK. It may depend on what tariffs are put on, whether or not the popularity of German cars continues in the UK. So it might be that the question around it may have more to do with the question of what tariffs between the UK and Japan. Perhaps speculation, but perhaps you could comment on that and also come in on the point.
Let me just follow up on just comments that Jane was saying. I think you have to distinguish between trade promotion and market access. And Brexit, no matter what the scenario, is going to reduce market access for British exports. So whatever strategy you're looking at has to be in the context of reduced market access, and whatever option is finally taken on the nature of Brexit will determine exactly how much market access will be lost. So we're talking about a degree of disintegration. So I think that needs to be part of the discussion, not just trade promotion, which is, you know, promoting your products. But if you have more restrained access to those markets, that's going to change the incentives for exporters. With respect to the convener's question, the Nissan cars are British made, assembled with parts from all over the world. So there'll be several factors which will influence the export of automobiles. One will be tariff rates, depending on what those are set at. In the sort of WTO option, we go to most favored nation tariff rates, which are significantly higher than the UK now faces when it exports to the EU. But there's also rules of origin. So it will depend on the content inside that automobile, which will determine the tariff rates. And so often when we talk about exports and production, we have to think most things are really globally assembled. They're not primarily built here. They're assembled here with parts from everywhere. So where this gets complicated is with the non-tariff barriers like rules of origin, which determine the kind of tariff that would be applied on the exported good. So it's not so much relationship between what EU's tariff rates are with Japan, but really what the terms of the British exit out of EU. So it's tariff agreement into EU market, but also with the rest of the world, because those will affect all the inputs and outputs that go into those automobiles as well.
I take your point that my question may have been too simplistic. I think it was more thinking about what cars British people would be buying, and certainly if tariffs are introduced, were to be introduced on German automobiles, there might become a huge appetite, a growing appetite for Japanese cars built in Britain, which might deal with the issue. Right, perhaps we could move on then. I think... Gil wanted to come in on some of the points made, and then Andy Whiteman, and then we'll come back to some of our guests who have indicated they would like to come in.
Can you indulge me? Could I just ask a quick question? I understand that automobile parts, that the tariff of parts is substantially lower, and that's a worldwide phenomenon. So parts, but the finished articles, that's where it goes in. But my main question is in relation to the stats in terms of exports, and it would suggest that there's some strong views that a substantial amount of Scottish exports are actually termed as English exports simply because they leave from English ports. Now, I just wonder if that is real or is it imaginary, or how one of the things, again, I said it last week, one of the problems that this committee has got is actually having stats that are reliable and peculiar to Scotland. They don't seem to really exist, and we rely on people like that sitting around this table to produce some of the information, rather than information that businesses here provide at the present time to the government, but it never comes back peculiar to Scotland.
Liz, do you want to comment on that? And then we'll come to Dr. Zuleg, who wanted to come in.
Yeah, I mean, it's a very astute observation. One of the problems is that British statistics are national. They're not broken down internally. So that makes it very difficult to actually know the extent of Scottish economy. Most of the statistics I've seen are based on surveys. So they're to some extent, limited data. There isn't really great Scottish statistics, and I think that's something the committee and I think the government as a whole should be thinking about, what kind of data is required to really make these kind of decisions, because in my former experience as a trade negotiator, you can't really make decisions on what is appropriate strategy unless you actually have a hard picture of what your economy looks like, and I think that's actually currently missing for Scotland and is a significant information gap.
Thank you. Dr. Zuleg.
Yeah, just picking up a couple of the points. I think what is clear is that there's still a very significant amount of uncertainty. There's uncertainty about timing, there's uncertainty about transition, and there's uncertainty about the final outcome. But I think what is also clear is the harder and the quicker Brexit is going to be, the higher the costs are going to be. Yeah. And that's, I think, the key question here being whether the UK continues to be in the single market. And that is qualitatively different from negotiated access to the single market. It's a binary choice. The single market is much more than a free trade agreement. If there is a free trade agreement rather than membership of the single market, then it will depend on when that will be negotiated. It is likely to be way into the future. We're not talking about a free trade agreement on exit. We're talking about a free trade agreement at some point in future, which is undefined at the moment. So I think there are a lot of questions. There are questions around what will happen with the UK and the WTO. The UK does not have a WTO schedule. It will have to negotiate a schedule. Again, there's a question of transition arrangements. But all of this will impose cost. And I think it's short-run costs, medium-run, and long-term dynamic costs. And I think that's where the really significant costs are going to come in. So there are some considerations whether there can be special deals. I think the one which I would think is highly unlikely is a special deal for any part of the UK to remain in the single market. If the UK leaves the single market, I think it's very unlikely that any part can remain. And then it's a question of negotiation. And I think special deals, for me, the big question is always, in whose give are they? Who will actually be the one who can decide on those special deals? And if we're talking about international trade, it's a negotiation game which involves give and take. And for me, the big question is always, what is the give from the UK government, which is going to be on the table to rescue some of the special provisions are there. And it shouldn't be forgotten, it's already been mentioned, that that also takes place within a framework which is already set. So WTO rules will prescribe certain things for the UK For example, if we're talking about agricultural subsidies, if we're talking about preferential trade deals, it is quite difficult to see how some of those will work under WTO rules. So it's not just the relationship between the EU and the UK, but it's also the relationship between the UK and the rest of the world, which will change fundamentally. Should Scotland then aim for the rest of the world rather than the rest of the EU? I think it's about both rather than either, and it's about taking into account this uncertainty, which will be there with WTO rules with the rest of the world. But there is also in economics a proximity factor. The closer countries are, the more you trade with them. Generally, that holds true regardless of the institutional arrangements. And just finally, on the Nissan case, we don't know what has been promised, but I think the key thing here is we shouldn't assume that UK car makers produce for the UK market. UK car makers produce for the European market, and that means it matters a lot whether there will be tariffs between cars which are exported from the UK to the continent. And that will also, I think, determine long-term decisions of car makers whether they continue to invest here. I think there are possibilities of trying to mitigate for some of this, but these possibilities are costly. State aids, for example, and then again you come back to the question of what is WTO compatible and what isn't.
Thank you. And Andy Whiteman, you wanted to come in with a question.
Thank you, Convener. Yes, following on from discussions about special deals, etc., I note from Four Consulting's paper that Edinburgh's economy is reliant on financial services to a greater degree than even London, and in terms of a European perspective, second only to Luxembourg. And I'm wondering if, given that financial services is a key export in the UK, what are the implications for the Scottish economy, particularly the Edinburgh and Lothian's economy, of whatever deal might be reached for financial services? Do financial services have a different profile in Scotland that are likely to be less or more impacted upon by exit from the European Union? Or are they the kind of services that would benefit to the same degree as the City of London if it secures any special deals on the future of passporting?
I'm wondering if Stephen Boyle has any comment on that. I'm happy for other guests, obviously, to comment who wish to come in on it.
I'll do my best, Convener. I don't carry these numbers around in my head precisely, but if I recall correctly, then exports of Scottish financial services to the rest of the UK are between 10 and 20 times the value of Scottish financial services exports outside of the UK. So the UK market matters to a very considerably greater extent for Scottish financial services than does the non-UK market. My expectation would be that that is quite different from the position that would apply in the City of London, where the non-UK market is likely to be much more significant than it is for Scotland.
Zuleg wanted to come in now.
Yeah, I just wanted to make one point regarding a special deal for financial services. I wouldn't necessarily assume that there will be a special deal for financial services in London. I think we have to look at what the EU27 might want out of these negotiations. And I think there is relatively little incentive to give competitors good access to the market without any kind of give from the UK. So if the UK does want to keep passporting for UK financial services, my question would be, what is the give going to be? What is it the UK is going to offer? Because it's not going to be an easy ride, in my opinion.
Roy, wanted to come in.
Yeah. It was just to reinforce Stephen's point about the makeup of the financial services sector in Scotland and its links into the rest of the UK, and that's quite crucial. And you can see that, you know, with, you know, things like, you know, the banks, RBS, for example, you know, you know, largely being a domestic bank, so the service to the rest of the UK is crucial, and that's the same with a number of the other big financial players in Edinburgh, Standard Life, etc., you know, very much into the rest of the UK market. And I guess there's a second issue in there as well about some of the companies which are much more open and trading internationally create large amounts of GVA and large amounts of turnover, but in terms of actual large numbers of employment, it's, you know, it's slightly less than potentially some of the ones which are more focused on the domestic side of things. So there's a distinction between the potential impacts on employment and also by other measures. And that starts to get into the point that I think Jackie Bailey was making around what markets do you go for, you know, and Fabian's entirely right. You know, we shouldn't forget the fact that, yes, trade deals are important, access to single market is important, but proximity is actually one of the most, you know, important things. So actually one of the big focuses, I think, for the Scottish Government and future policy around is actually access, you know, is actually, you know, support and integration into the UK market and what they can do around, you know, support for growing expansion in there. And if you look at one of the reasons why Scotland has struggled with all this in the past, it's about growing small businesses into medium-sized businesses, and actually that access to your actual local market is actually really quite crucial there, and that's where access there is really important. And again, back to my point about the differences by sector, again, will be quite crucial. So you take a product such as whiskey. Yes, it exports a lot of goods into the European Union, but actually exports, you know, a lot more globally. So there is something where actually there has opportunities to focus into other markets. But if you take a product such as fresh fish, you know, you can't really export that to Australia. So a free trade deal with Australia is all well and good, but you're not going to export your West Coast fish Lagostines out there. So there's an important point to think about all of that. And the actual results will be determined by individual sector. Just picking up Gail's point about the data. I mean, I think, you know, it's easy to knock the data, and the data isn't perfect, and it is based on surveys, but, you know, the numbers that we have for Scotland are the best that we've got. They are national statistics. They are based upon questions to companies about where is your end market, where are you exporting to? So it relies on companies knowing ultimately where they're exporting to. So I would say that for the most part, they're pretty accurate about finding where the final export market is. Where it becomes much more interesting and much more difficult to pick up are where you potentially might be part of a supply chain. So you're maybe part of an element that is going to the UK to then extend over into the European Union. And that's where I think, you know, our modelling was quite carefully to look at the potential shock, not just to Scotland, but also to the rest of the UK. So if I'm a firm in Edinburgh producing a good which is part of a supply chain going to a company in Leicester and then going into the European Union, actually understanding that supply chain becomes really quite crucial as well. So we need to think about the potential impacts of Brexit, not just in terms of exporters, but actually people in Scottish economy, part of a much bigger supply chain that is actually into the European Union. So that becomes quite important as well.
Right, thank you. I'm trying to just make sure everyone gets in. I know Gordon MacDonald had a quick question on that, followed up, and then I'll come to two of our guests, Jenny Stewart and Jane Gotts. Gordon.
So just to build on Andy's point about the importance of financial services to the Edinburgh economy, recently Anthony Brown, the chief executive of the British Bankers Association, said many smaller banks plan to start relocations before Christmas. Bigger banks are expected to start in the first quarter of next year. And Mark Kearney, when he was asked last week in the House of Lords about this point, says, "We are aware of the contingency plans that are in various stages of readiness at those institutions." And I'm just wondering, what would be the impact in Scotland if there was starting to be relocations of some of the larger players? And is there also an opportunity for Scotland if we decide the EU membership should be retained?
Right. I know Jenny Stewart wanted to come in and Jane Gotts, and I don't know who would be best placed to perhaps provide an answer to the question that Gordon has put into the room. I don't know, Stephen Boyle, would you? But we'll move first to Jenny Stewart and Jane Gotts so that...
Thank you. It was just to pick up on the points around financial services impact on the Edinburgh economy. As others have said, clearly there is a big distinction. Different parts of the financial services will be affected differently. So the 80,000 or 90,000 jobs that depend on financial services in Scotland directly, with large amounts of those probably in retail banking, there is no single market effectively in retail banking between ourselves and the EU, so that won't be affected. But the investment side, there's a paper which has been produced recently, Strathclyde University, by Owen Kelly and ex-chief executive SFE and Jeremy Peat, and that goes into quite a bit of detail around the different different elements and how they might be affected and who are more exposed to the UK versus the EU. So it might be worth looking at that. Just on the relocation point, and clearly there are contingency plans around for those based in the City of London. Then is it worth? I might just explain the passporting requirement, because it does pull out the point about, we've talked a lot about freedom of movement, but freedom of capital and being able to invest in other countries. So effectively what that means for the financial services institutions coming out of the EU is that if we don't get passporting, that means they will have to set up subsidiaries in the EU, capitalise those subsidiaries in order to continue to provide services. So that's a significant issue for them there, and therefore what impact, how they address that and what their ownership structures and so on ought to be. So clearly there are potential relocation activities. It may be issues around headquarters, but it might also be around particular groups of staff. So, you know, investment banking, more exposed. Therefore, actually, it might be about how many people do we need to put in Luxembourg by quarter one next year to be ready to deal with that. So it's slightly more complex than just a headquarters point.
Thank you. Jane Gotts.
Yeah, it was really just building on the point Graham had made on the statistics, and I would agree with Graham that I think the statistics that the Scottish Government produce in terms of exports is the best that we can get in terms of getting access from company information. But it's interesting to note, despite the proximity in terms of trade, Scotland's biggest market is the USA by over 2 billion between its nearest rivals. So we export £4 billion worth of goods to the United States. And actually, our biggest market in the European Union, determined by the statistical information, is Holland at 1.9 billion. Now, we know that a lot of that trade is going through Holland and then going out through the ports. So again, it refers back to Graham's comments about the final destination of our exports. But what I would, the reason for saying that is to again just look at the potential impact on the Scottish economy of actually knowing in more detail, if possible, of who is generating, what companies are generating the bulk of these exports. Is the USA primarily determined by USA-owned businesses here in Scotland? I think that is information that isn't necessarily available, and I think that would be welcome to actually understand any more potential risks and also opportunities for the Scottish economy. And also, the food and drink market actually has experienced over a 12% growth in exports to China, but that's actually growing for demand in terms of Scottish products are at the very, very high end of the market. And again, that's an interesting area that should probably be explored in more detail. How do we actually take advantage of growing economies, growing wealth in other markets throughout the world to actually say, well, what are the niche Scottish products that could be going out to these markets?
Thank you. Stephen Boyle.
Returning to Gordon MacDonald's point, my first observation would be that it is exceptionally rare for headquarters to relocate. Exceptionally rare. And other than the event of takeovers, it's very rare to see headquarters change where they are. So I wouldn't expect to see much by way of the movement of headquarters either in or out as a consequence of that.
Headquarters.
Okay, thank you. Well, to come on then to what I think is the nature of the tussle or the trade-off here. If you look at financial services to which you referred, then depending on the terms of the agreements that are subsequently struck, I would expect that we would be in a position where the costs of doing business from the UK would be higher than they are now, the barriers to trade would be higher than they are now.
and that that would cause some functions to leave the UK. But pulling against that are at least two factors. One is that there are very substantial agglomeration economies that businesses benefit from being in London in particular. The fact that you're part of a richer labour market, the fact that you're part of an extensive supply chain, means that the costs of going somewhere else are not negligible. So that'll be the trade-off that, that businesses are making. And I think to the point that Jenny Stewart made, you know, were a business to decide that it needed to be in European Union member states in order to conduct its business, I think what it would, amongst the options that it would consider, would be establishing an operation in that country specifically for that business, for that purpose, rather than necessarily taking its operation wholesale from London to the third country.
Thank you. Dean Lockhart, did you want to come in on this financial point?
It was actually another point.
Right, well, I'll bring you in in due course then. I think John Mason has been waiting to get in with
a different point, yes. Although something has been touched on already. I mean, we've talked about exports quite a lot, but primarily it was to go back to what Jenny Stewart said, touching on exchange rates. Because I feel, I mean, that is something that has actually happened. The exchange rate has already changed. It strikes me that a lot of people seem to be very relaxed about this. And so the first question is, well, if the exchange rate goes down, does that automatically mean that exports go up? Can we just sit back and watch the whiskey exports go up and up and up? And what really is the impact? Jenny Stewart mentioned remittances back to other countries, which some people are living here and doing that. What happens about foreign investment? Does that make it more or less likely that people invest in Britain if the pound is... Has it gone down and it stopped, or is it going to go down? I mean, when I was younger, we laughed at Italy and Greece because their currencies was thousands to the pound. So, I mean, it strikes me that an exchange rate is quite an important thing, and it reflects the strength of the economy and creates an image around the world. I mean, people seem to be surprised that the price of tea is going up, despite the fact I don't think we grow any tea here that I've noticed. So, of course, the price of tea is going up, and presumably the price of quite a lot of things are going up. And where are we going with that? Is that a factor?
Come back on it. So clearly the exchange rate and the fall in the pound has been very significant. Couple of direct implications from that. I think people were surprised in the initial fall in the pound, and then equities rose. People didn't really understand why the stock market was going up when the pound was falling. But actually what that reflected in a lot of cases was because for a lot of companies, their income is denominated in dollars, for example, a lot of the oil and gas industry, then actually a fall in the pound was pretty helpful to them, and therefore share prices were going up.
Just to absolutely clarify that, so if they sold a barrel of oil or something in for so many dollars, that just automatically meant they got more pounds. So they hadn't actually sold any more or done anything.
Yeah.
Right, I'm with you. Right.
Yeah.
Okay, thanks.
So there's that impact. Clearly then there's potentially a positive impact on exports, although we haven't yet seen in terms of the data whether that's feeding through significantly yet. But that's important. The other is the impact on inflation, as you touched on. So clearly, because we as an economy export an awful lot more, import an awful lot more than we export, then obviously if that, because of the exchange rate, then overall in the economy, the expectation is that will then feed through into increased inflation. And the Bank of England's inflation report's coming out on Thursday, but so far what they have suggested, and others have said, well, we're sitting at inflation at about 1% just now. It will potentially go up to 2.5-2.6-ish over the course of the 2017, and might even hit 2023 and 2018. So the drop in the pound, that kind of inflationary effect, might take a while to come through. But then again, it depends what the Bank of England does. The Bank of England have got their remit in monetary policy is to impact, is to target inflation. So they're in a bind around, OK, we're keeping interest rates low, but equally we want to control inflation. So that's why the pound is so, and the value of the pound is such a fundamental issue for the economy as a whole, but also for individual businesses.
On the point of time scales, you said that's going to come through over time. Is that partly because energy companies, supermarkets are buying ahead, so they fix the price for a certain distance?
Some of that, and yet other goods, you know, it will be almost instantaneous. So we'll just have to see how that all feeds through.
Okay.
Right. I think Stephen Boyle, Dr. Zuleg, Richard Marsh, and then Dr. Matthias wanted to come in. So perhaps in that order, if I ask Stephen Boyle to give his comments on this.
So on to John Mason's point about the impact of the exchange rate reduction, so it's down about 15% since the referendum. It's probably down closer to 20% across this year as a whole. So there already has been a very substantial adjustment in the exchange rate. And let's assume for a moment that was to be sustained, that there wasn't to be any recovery in that. Then on the face of it, that represents a substantial gain, potential gain to exporters, that they can either take higher revenue for the same volumes, or they can adjust their prices and take higher profits. There's another dimension to this, however, which is, as Jenny Stewart's explained, input costs are rising. And what we've already seen in the UK as a whole is a very sharp increase in input prices as a consequence of the exchange rate fall that's come through really quickly. So who wins and who loses in this context depends on the balance between your dependence on export revenues and imported costs. And there are some sectors, like the drinks industry, that have very limited imported costs but very substantial export revenues that will clearly gain from this. And more generally, the sectors that are going to gain look to me to be in the service sector, where imported inputs are not a big part of what they do, but they have some level of export. The losers look predominantly to be the manufacturing sector because of the nature of supply chains. So you might be exporting, but you've actually got a substantial amount of imported input content. There are other types of winners and losers out of this as well. So again, Jenny Stewart referred to what the average increase in inflation might be. But different types of household are affected in different ways by this change in the exchange rate. So if you look at where the input cost rises have been greatest so far, they've been greatest in things like energy, food and clothing. Those are items that constitute a higher proportion of the spending of older households and poorer households than the rest of the country. So those are households that are likely to be disproportionately adversely affected. Final point very quickly, you might not see all of these points manifest themselves quickly. For example, you might not see the change in import or export volumes because businesses hedge their currency risk. So they're protected against movements in the exchange rate for a period of time, anything up to a year or more.
Thank you. Dr. Zuleg.
Yes, just to make a couple of points on this, export performance depends on many factors, and exchange rate is one factor, but depending on the sector, it's very often not even the most important factor. It depends on a lot of other factors as well. And you can see that very easily if you look at the experience we've had in Europe. Before we had the euro, you had a number of countries which periodically had competitive devaluations of their currency, and it didn't solve their export problems, certainly not sustainably. The other factor which is important is how responsive demand is, both demand abroad and demand in Britain to price. So if the price changes, then will you get a big effect? And generally, at least on consumer prices, there tends to be quite inelastic demand. So that means that the exchange rate loss, which will be there, will be passed on to consumers within probably a relatively short period of time. It's also important to note that volatility in itself imposes a cost. So it's not necessarily whether the pound is high or low, but if it fluctuates a lot, it is very difficult, especially for SMEs, to deal with the costs of a fluctuating currency. So stability has a value in itself, which I think we are going to see is still under threat, because when you look at the exchange rate at the moment, the exchange rate still moves predominantly with events in the political sphere. So whenever you have a consideration that Brexit might be harder, you see a further deterioration of the pound. If people think there's a chance that the UK or parts of the UK stay within the single market, then you see an improvement. So it depends a lot on the politics and whatever the final outcome is going to be. If we are truly moving towards a very hard Brexit, then I would expect the pound to fall even further.
Thank you. Richard Marsh.
Just a quick point. I think we're in danger of having a room with several economists all agreeing with each other. But it was just to follow up with Stephen Boyle's point. There is some data out there from the Scottish Government's input output tables, which looks at the balance between what you export and what you import. And so you can actually look at some of the winners and losers. And we did a quick list, and towards the top is absolutely, it's the food and drink type sectors, with whiskey at the very top of the table, because it exports a great deal of its output and it uses the natural resources from within Scotland. So it just intuitively is potentially a big winner. Towards the bottom of the pile would be sectors around energy, as Stephen's just said. But you've also got in there sectors like health and public administration that have quite significant purchases from outside of the UK in specialist equipment and plant. Now, it actually exports very, very little because it's public services. But there's no particular... I think it was quite difficult to say whether Scotland would be a winner or a loser from this position. But what I'd note from the stats are there would be some significant winners within specific sectors of Scotland's economy, and there would be some sectors that are going to have to source things from outside of the UK. And the point made by Fabian, they've got very little choice over this. It would require some fairly significant changes in the economies of Scotland and the UK to adjust supply chains.
Thank you. And finally, Dr. Margulis.
Yeah, just a quick point, just to much of what I want to say has been said. So I think this just sort of reinforces the importance of better understanding where Scotland fits in global supply chains, because we can't really answer this question of what the change in the currency, how it will affect exports, and so we actually know what the global supply chains look like and can understand within sectors how those changes might play out.
Thank you. Now, Richard Leonard had a question.
I wonder whether any of our expert witnesses have got any examples of actually existing companies who are making contingency plans. I mean, Jenny's mentioned as early as quarter one next year. Fabian Zulig talked about perhaps over time there would be a potential disinvestment. James Gott spoke about the extent to which some of the commanding heights of the Scottish economy are now foreign-owned, which you would expect would lead potentially to a kind of branch plant approach, a possible retrenchment, which also leads me to ask the people around the table whether they think that now makes it even more compelling that we have an industrial strategy which looks at how we plug the gap in the kind of the medium-sized enterprises, how we try and develop the indigenous industrial base and become perhaps less reliant on foreign direct investment as a way of transforming the economy.
Dr. Zulig.
I think it's very difficult to say when the disinvestment will happen, but I would say that at least for larger companies, I would be astonished if there's no contingency planning. That would be a failure towards their shareholders if they're not doing some contingency planning at the moment. Whether that means they will plan to leave or not is a different question. But I think that in the long run, we will see an effect on investment. It does mean that there will be more reliance on indigenous growth. How that can be best promoted, I think, is a big question, both technically and from an economic perspective. The kind of industrial strategies we've seen in some countries have not worked particularly well in growing medium-sized companies. Also, for medium-sized companies, it is generally the case that the international market is very important. They are not just oriented towards the national market. So the question is, if you look at successful countries like Germany with medium-sized businesses, they are very international. So the question is how you can internationalize those kind of companies. And on top of that, I think there's a big question about what kind of industrial strategy will even be possible, both within the UK framework and in the WTO framework. There are big questions about what kind of instruments you could use and also what the response then would be from other countries who will very much react to the kind of industrial strategy Scotland or the UK puts into place.
Thank you. Jane Gotts.
So again, just to add to that, I think it's too difficult a question to answer in this context, but it's important to have that blend. I mean, Scotland's been phenomenally successful in recent years in terms of attracting foreign investment, the best foreign investment outside of London in the UK in terms of attracting overseas businesses into Scotland. So that should always be a priority to try and maintain that. But at the same time, look at where the potential gaps are in our economy, look at where there are opportunities for Indigenous businesses. And the other thing to mention, we've not talked about, and it was John's point earlier, about where the opportunities are. The tourism sector, I know we mentioned it briefly, but with the drop in the pound, you know, there are huge potential to really grow our tourism sector. But of course, it's a double-edged sword because we know that there are a lot of European citizens working within the tourism sector within Scotland. So how do you manage a potential boom in tourism because of a falling pound at the same time as making sure that we've got enough people to actually service that industry? So it's not questions that we can answer just now, but they all have to be on the table for consideration.
Thank you. And Dean Lockhart, you had a question.
Thank you, Convener. It's a question for Dr. Roy. Dr. Roy, in your submission, you quite rightly challenge policymakers to examine the policy opportunities that may open up as a result of Brexit. I have two questions for you. First of all, with the report you prepared for the EU committee a couple of months ago, am I right in thinking that this report only looked at three Brexit scenarios, the Norway model, the Swiss model, and the WTO model, and did not take into account potential upside coming from new trade deals with countries such as India, China, and the US? And the second question is, we've heard about potential opportunities across different sectors for exports and different sectors across the Scottish economy. How can we best explore these opportunities going forward? I think it is incumbent upon policymakers to address both the challenges but also the opportunities arising from Brexit. What steps would you recommend that we take going forward as a committee to explore these opportunities?
Okay, thanks. On the first point about the modelling, so what the modelling does is look at essentially what could be potential impacts from different trade models for Scotland and the UK in a post-Brexit world. And we're quite clear that what it does is isolate what's the impact of Brexit. So what is the implications from having less trade integration with your largest international market? And that's what it does. And that's essentially the modelling that we do. You're entirely right. You then get into things like, OK, well, what might be the potential policy responses? What might be the different things that could flow from that? The reason we don't model that is, well, there is no clarity about what Brexit will be, let alone what policy opportunities might come from that. But there's also, I guess, we need to put it in context with that as well. So it's entirely possible that we could have trade deals with other countries outside the European Union. But we have to put these numbers into context as well. And it's entirely possible, and it is, you know, ways that you could potentially improve trade into these countries. But if you take somewhere like Australia, for example, where we know there's been hints and stuff about potential trade deals with Australia, let's just suppose we were to increase our exports to Australia by a third. That would equate to less than 2% of total exports to the EU. So yes, we can get trade deals with other countries. Yes, we can expand there. But you've got to put it in context, just the relative size. I guess the second point, and it's been touched on a wee bit in the questions here, is that there's quite a difference between something like a single market and free trade deals or trade arrangements with other countries, because what a single market gives you is a level playing field to have that trade as well. So it means that there's rules to stop exploitation of workers. It means there's rules to harmonise product regulation, etc. So yes, you can enter into a trade deal with China, for example, but, you know, what might be the worker rights in China for goods that are being exported into the UK? Would you want to enter in a trade deal with that? What might be the implications? We've seen all the challenges around TTIP and the potential concerns that people have had about American companies coming into public services. So your point is entirely right and entirely correct. And I think that's what we're encouraging people to start to think about is, OK, if Brexit happens, we know it's going to introduce headwinds to growth rather than be growth enhancing. So what are the potential policy opportunities you can do to mitigate the worst of these effects and also look at potential opportunities to do things differently? And there I think you have to start to get creative to think about, well, what policy levers have the Scottish Government got at the moment that they could do things differently? What potential policy opportunities might come from greater devolution that might come down the line? So if we're prevented in having VAT or excise duties in the past because of EU regulations, what could happen if these were to be devolved to the Scottish Parliament? What might you do differently if you've got a greater suite of fiscal powers? What might you do with the powers that come from agriculture, etc.? So I think that's when you have to put these opportunities in context. Even with all of these things, Brexit will still be a headwind in growth. But the reality is that if Brexit is happening, you start to have to look at what you do about changing policy in response.
Thank you very much. In your blog earlier this week, you mentioned that we shouldn't let Brexit overcloud everything else. Some of the challenges facing the Scottish economy have been there for years, and I welcome that, because would you agree that while Brexit is a possible headwind, there are structural issues in the Scottish economy that we need to deal with and that have been there for years?
Yeah, I mean, I would agree with that statement, apart from the phrase that Brexit could be a possible headwind. I'd probably say that Brexit is a headwind. But yeah, you're entirely right that, you know, the structural challenges we've had in the Scottish economy around our internationalisation, the growth of small to medium-sized companies, has been there. And Brexit isn't going to help address that, but it's potentially an opportunity to take a fresh look and a frank assessment of actually how do we actually, you know, start to address these structural challenges that we've had.
Thank you. Before I bring in some of our guests, I would like to give Ash Denham an opportunity to ask. I think that was a question about long term, perhaps, and I think question about short term implications, and then I'll try and bring the rest of our guests in as we come to the end of our session.
Thank you, Convener. Yes, it may be that my question has been partially covered, but I just wanted to reflect as well. Also, I think the Fraser of Allender grouped this into sort of short-term considerations. So we've seen, no doubt, newspaper headlines in the last few weeks sort of crowing about the predictions of economic doom that were forecast haven't quite come to pass. And obviously, we've already touched on the sharp fall in sterling, which probably would fit into that category. The Fraser of Allender, the quote that they've put in regarding this is that we should be wary of expecting to see any immediate changes. I suppose my question is that even though we maybe haven't seen the full impact of Brexit come to pass yet, that doesn't mean that it's coming. And I'm wondering if you would reflect on when you think we might see some more impacts.
Yeah, so I mean, the short term, the short term challenges are really quite complex. And if you speak to most economists, there is a relative consensus about what the long term headwinds of something like Brexit will be, because the stuff we've spoken about today around trade, investment, access to skilled migration, etc. What happens in the short term is much more complex, as we've heard about. Businesses tend to wait and see what's happening. You tend to be driven in the short run very much about day-to-day supply and demand things. So what your orders are like, what's happening to interest rates, what's happening to the exchange rate in the short term. These are things that dominate very much in the short term. And there's lots of things happening on the positive side which will help boost the economy, and lots of things that happen on the negative side that turn out to be more difficult. I think what most forecasts, if you look at what the average of forecasters are saying about the outlook for the next wee while, most people did think that the economy would be slower in 2016 as a result of Brexit because of the uncertainty. The data we've had so far, and I would caution that and say that it's what we've got so far. So we've only got the first 3 months after the referendum. A lot of it is based on modelled data, etc. But putting that aside, the data we've got has surprised on the upside. But most economists were predicting the real challenge will come in 2017 and 2018. So that's when the decisions on investment start to kick in. If you made a decision to invest in 2016, you're unlikely to throw everything out immediately, because you'll wait to see greater clarity. But it's, well, what's the next decision? And what were your expansion plans like? They may be cooled slightly. So you'd expect to see things beginning to trickle through more into next year and the year after. And that's why in our forecast, we're thinking that 2017 will actually be slightly more challenging for Scotland than 2016. And most independent forecasts, if you look at the ones that the Treasury produce, are talking about 2017, 2018 being slightly more challenging than the 2016. And I guess the key thing with that is, as well, is about what happens to inflation. And we know that inflation has risen up to 1%. Even in the Bank of England's report in August, they were talking about inflation rising to 2.4% in 2018. And that really starts to kick in, about household consumption and what it means for households going forward. And just picking up one really quick aside about that, and Stephen made the point really well about the impact on different households. One of the things we've not spoken about is the potential impacts on, the poorest households, and we know that they typically, face the highest increases in terms of food prices, energy prices, etc. But also, when you start to think about what might happen in the autumn statement about what's the future outlook for welfare, we know that a number of benefits plan to be frozen. Frozen. If you get higher inflation, well, that actually potentially makes the challenge to people on welfare benefits, all the more difficult. A pay award in the public sector of 1% is challenging, but when inflation is 0.5%, it's still a real terms increase. But if inflation rises to 2.5%, 3%. That pay award of 1% suddenly starts to become much more difficult. And that's when you start to see the potential challenges coming through to consumption, not just investment, but actual consumption in 2017 and 2018.
So if we just talk about specific helpful measures that either the Scottish Government or the UK Government could do in the short term. So obviously the Bank of England have cut interest rates currently, and the Scottish Government have obviously launched their £500 million growth scheme. Is there anything else that any of our panellists would like to suggest?
Well, perhaps we could answer that question as part of our response. I think Jenny Stewart wanted to come in. Perhaps you could address that question as part of your closing remarks, as it were.
Just on the... We've talked about the short-term impacts not being as significant. On business investment, there's so much that can still change. So we're looking at, as Graham said, reduced... improvement next year, so those are changing. Interestingly, the forecasts for 2017 have gradually been shifting up a little bit as more positive data has been coming through. So originally, in the weeks post Brexit, people thought the UK economy, the consensus was about 3-5% for next year, whereas now the consensus is hovering about 0.8% for next year. So if we continue on relatively positively, then that has a good starting place for next year. On the business investment, and it was going back to Richard's point around that, I wouldn't want to give the impression that it's suddenly going to fall off fall off a cliff. So businesses, you know, will be thinking through things. They will be making contingency plans. But we will have to see what happens going through, particularly the autumn statement will be impacting. In terms of other points, I just wanted to throw in that you might want to consider. We haven't talked much about skills yet, and clearly that has been a significant issue in the Scottish economy. We've got some significant skills gaps, which may be made worse by Brexit, particularly around construction, but also around just looking forward. We touched on the digital agenda and technology. So again, that might be something the committee wants to look at. We also haven't touched on the higher education sector at all in the discussion so far, and they potentially will be significantly affected by the freedom of movement issue, because as I understand it, something like 16% of staff and 25% of researchers come from other EU countries. So again, that as a sector is certainly worth looking at, because it does contribute significantly to the economy.
Thank you. And Dr. Zulek.
I think what is important to emphasize is it hasn't happened yet, and it isn't scheduled to happen for 2.5 years. Mm-hmm. So the effects we're seeing are anticipation of what people actually are thinking, not the effect itself. And the effect itself will only be felt after the Brexit has happened, and then it is a long-run dynamic effect, which I think is much more important. So it's the interplay between innovation, between freedom of movement, between foreign direct investment. All of these will play together to have a long-term, in my view, significant growth reduction effect on the UK as a whole. And at the moment, there is still quite a bit of speculation that there will still be, for example, parts of the UK still in the single market. There will still be questions around passporting, etc. If that doesn't come true, we will see a further effect, because as the markets start to anticipate a harder and harder Brexit, the bigger the costs are going to be. So that's, I think, what we would expect going forward. I think just one other point on what the committee should do. I think one of the issues which tends to be neglected a bit in this discussion is the relationship between the UK and the rest of the world. Not the UK-EU relationship, but what actually happens in foreign trade. And there is a huge potential. Certainly, there's a very high uncertainty about what will come afterwards, and there's a huge potential for damage in that. And the question of assuming that there might be free trade agreements with all these places around the world, that might be the case, but that's quite a big ask to negotiate, and it takes a lot of time, and it will require quite a lot of giving up on the UK side to actually get trade deals with these places. If you look at something like the trade deal which the EU has just concluded with Canada, it's a huge book. It's 2,600 pages, because that is the big difference between being in a single market where you can have a level playing field or having to negotiate access on every individual point. And that's a huge area where I think the UK government needs to be pressed more to say what are the contingency plans for the day X, which is the day after Brexit happens, because all of the current trade deal and the schedule of the EU will no longer apply to the UK on that day.
And Dr. Margulis, and perhaps we could also yourself and then Stephen Boyle address the question of what the Scottish government could be doing about this at this stage.
I just want to echo how much of a Herculean task it's going to be for the British government to not only renegotiate its trade relationship with the EU, but also with all the existing 50 countries the EU has FTAs, preferential trading agreements with, that the UK currently enjoys. So what we're looking about is about a safe estimate, several decades of just renegotiating the current access the UK currently enjoys. And the idea of sort of upside down the road We're talking decades away, because the reality is the UK has not negotiated a trade agreement since the late 70s. It has no capacity to negotiate these agreements. And the reality is also now it is a much smaller economy. It does not have the leverage in negotiations it did have as the EU. So when it does strike new deals, they're likely to be not as good as the deals it currently has. And nobody's getting in line to sign trade deals with the UK. It's not that important of economy globally. It's not the country as most other nations are lining up to trade with. So I think there has to be also some realism of where the UK sits in the global picture. In terms of long-term or things the Scottish government can do, I think it's really important to start a consultation process with stakeholders across sectors to get a better sense of what their concerns are, and also identifying the kind of measures that will need to be put in the interim just to replace the types of supports or benefits that the UK currently enjoys under the EU, which might disappear when it leaves. So these are things like agricultural subsidies or state aid. It can't assume it's going to be able to use the same things going forward. So I think just as an interim measure, figuring out what kind of mitigation capacity it does have.
Thank you. And Stephen Boyle.
In a very narrow sense, I think one thing we can do is stop obsessing about Brexit. And I say that for this reason. What Graham Roy's work and his colleagues' work shows is that at its heart, Brexit presents a growth challenge. It makes the growth prospects of Scotland's economy poorer than they otherwise would have been. But we've been on a journey for a long time to try to improve Scotland's rate of growth, and I think this just provides a further stronger justification for doing that. So what does that mean in practice? Above all, I think it means on the side of government, at the margin, continuing to change the balance of spending when decisions are being made towards investment, which means away from consumption. That's difficult to do, but that investment will pay off in terms of longer-term growth. Specifically around dealing with the narrower Brexit-related issues that arise, my judgment would be that if we have got, for argument's sake, a fixed pot of money that we use for the purposes of promoting internationalisation, that money is more productively likely to be spent on future and export promotion than it is on the attraction of foreign direct investment.
Thank you. Well, I think we'll wind up there, because we're at the end, certainly, of the time available to us, and we wouldn't want to be accused of obsessing about Brexit. So thank you very much to all of our guests. I'll close the session there. Thank you very much.